officials throughout the state to force the homeless into shelters when temperatures dip below freezing, and vowed to defend the edict if challenged in court. The order, which takes effect on Tuesday, requires social service agencies and police to move homeless individuals into shelters against their will if necessary when the temperature is at or below 32 degrees Fahrenheit, 0 degrees Celsius. The order also requires shelters to extend hours of operation to ensure that homeless people can stay inside whenever there is inclement winter weather, which can cause hypothermia, serious injury, and death. According to the order, state law allows for the involuntary placement of homeless individuals so they do not cause harm to themselves or others. Officials at the Coalition for the Homeless Advocacy Group in New York City could not be reached for comment. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
It's the Onion Radio News. A spokeswoman gives birth to a spokeschild. This is Doyle Redland reporting. Tacoma spokeswoman Tammy Barker became the proud mother of a bouncing baby spokeschild last night. According to spokespeople, Barker, a spokeswoman for a Tacoma-based pharmaceutical firm, the birthing process was a major success. Peter Wahlberg, spokesman for Tammy's husband Phil, had this to say.
At 9:17 p.m. last night, an 8.5-month-old spokesfetus was delivered alive and through the miracle of birth became a 7-pound, 6-ounce spokeschild. Spokesfather and spokesmother are doing fine.
Spokeswoman Barker is expected to be released from St. Robert's Hospital tomorrow. The spokeschild will remain in the hospital's media care unit for several weeks of training. Doyle Redland for The Onion Radio News, online at theonion.com.
This is The Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live, and you're invited to join us here. We'll give you our toll-free numbers and the Skype username in a moment. It's Ian and Rich Paul in the studio tonight. Rich, welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
Took a little vacation down to see the family in Michigan, so always good to have you here. And we've got a special guest co-host with us here tonight. Joel Valenzuela is joining us. You're living in Concord these days, right, Joel?
For about one more day.
Oh, really? Where are you going now?
Somewhere towards the coast. I've been looking at Lee specifically. It's a fun little farming town.
You, like Rich and I, are an early mover as part of the Free State Project. You created the Rights Brigade. And pretty much, was it last year, early last year? When did that start up?
Yes, exactly. January of 2015.
And how long have you lived in New Hampshire so far for the Free State Project?
A little over 2 years. I moved about mid-2013.
And so you kicked off Rights Brigade. What was your inspiration?
Well, my inspiration was actually Keene and Keene activism, because there was every single time I'd interact with people from different areas, the constant narrative was, well, what's going on in Manchester? What's going on in Concord? What's going on the coast? There's nothing going on. There's no activism going on. And there was, but there was little... little bursts here and there, and largely undocumented and
I think there's a lot of activism going on in Manchester and the coast and Concord and elsewhere, but I think the key is it's not being documented. And,
exactly.
I wonder where the leftists would stand on the issue of undocumented libertarians.
Well, we can come back and talk about the leftists here, because they're on the attack on this situation out in Oregon. I don't know if you've been following it, Rich, with the guys who've taken over, people who've taken over a government facility at a national level.
I have been following it. I think we'll probably find a lot of stuff on that.
I do want to talk about that. But
I'm kind of curious.
Joel a little bit here.
Yeah, I think that's a good plan.
So Rights Brigade, you were inspired by the idea that there needed to be more coverage for the things that were happening in other areas of New Hampshire.
Yes, exactly. It seemed to me like every single person of consequence who was doing anything, was no matter where in the state, was ending up blogging it at freekeen.com, because there was no other machinery sort of set up to let people know what was actually happening here. And I thought, well, there should be other vehicles to sort of report on this kind of stuff. And especially I wanted to set up a vehicle just to organize and report, and just sort of purely, and not do, because I spread the ideas of liberty through other media. And I part of the integral an integral part of the plan was to separate that from the overarching message from each individual act of activism, so as not to sort of thrust the whole package of the ideology upon each thing. So I could say, hey, look, we're standing up for gun rights here, and show that to the conservatives, get them all up, get them all on our side. Oh, we're standing up for the jury rights, and you get some libertarians there. Or we're standing up for marijuana rights or topless freedom or whatever other thing, and get each and isolate each instance. And for example, that's been there's been a lot of success with the Free Uber campaign in Portsmouth because of its sort of single issue focus. That's really brought a lot of people from a lot of different political grounds all on the same issue, all on the same side, and had very pretty limited controversy from the public in general regarding that issue.
That was much like the 420 rally strategy, which is I always said that the 420 Foundation is not an anarchist organization, even though I happen to run it and I happen to be an anarchist. It's an issue organization. And I think it's also very similar to what I'm trying to do with Rand Paul, where I'm making common cause with him. But at the same time, if I'm at a rally, I'm probably working the activists more than I'm working the audience, because, you know, I'm looking for the guy who can be radicalized one step further. And anywhere you find people who are right on even one issue, you find somebody who can be who has a chance of seeing the light on other issues.
I tend to agree. And I took some heat recently because I helped out the ladies with the Free the Nipple campaign out on the seacoast. For listeners who are unfamiliar, check out our Saturday show. We talked about it for a few hours in that case. But basically, ladies who are protesting the unconstitutional, arguably unconstitutional ordinances that ban women from being topless on a couple of beaches in New Hampshire. I went to their hearing of their trial and recorded video of that and, you know, helped publicize what was going on. And somebody attacked because, well, apparently one of the ladies in question is anti-gun. She's anti, you know, open carry, anti-concealed carry, anti-gun in general.
She just doesn't like guns. She's anti-gun.
And that's and so, you know, the point of view of the person who was criticizing was that, oh, well, she's anti-gun, so you shouldn't help her. And I said, well, that's not how I see it. I think that, you know, we need to work with people who agree with us where we agree with them. And when you're, you know, generous to people and you're kind towards people, they're more likely to actually listen to what you have to say. You know, if a conversation were to happen to come up about guns, is she going to be more likely to listen to something I have to say about it or something some heckler has to say about it?
Exactly. And that's been something I've been promoting for a long time, is a kind and professional public attitude. And so someone who has an interaction with you, even if they don't agree with you on the issue, will view the issue sort of through the lens of knowing that person that they like. If they were, oh, I know that guy, he's cool, he helped me with the Free the Nipple activism, he's a good guy. And then when that person disagrees with her on the gun issue, it's much less likely to have like a knee-jerk reaction. It's more, well, I don't agree with him, but he's a good guy. And then much more likely to hear your arguments.
Absolutely. So if you want to join us here, we're kind of just having a general discussion about activism. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, but you can also bring up whatever you want. It is Free Talk Live, and still the Oregon situation is developing. I didn't see any big headlines today beyond that the Hammonds, the father and son, have gone ahead and turned themselves into prison, which is what they were expected to do today.
Oh, okay.
To continue serving an extended sentence. These are the guys who were sentenced about a decade ago to like a year or less in jail for setting some fires that ended up catching onto federal lands, apparently, over by the Malheur, I think it's Malheur, Federal Wildlife Reserve in Oregon. And then a judge came back later and said, oh, I didn't sentence you hard enough. You're going to have to, now that you've gotten done with your sentence, you've got to come back for another 4 years of prison. Which is one of the reasons why there are now dozens purportedly of people that have taken basically occupied with weapons a federal building out in this federal wildlife reserve.
Is, Is that how it played out? Because I, the way I understood the story, and it's always like three levels removed from the source, so mm-hmm. it's all very vague. But my understanding was that they had appealed their original sentencing to a mandatory minimum of 5 years. And the appeals court has said, you're right, that mandatory minimum is unconstitutional, and kicked it back to district court or wherever it was originally tried.
I haven't heard anything about an appeal.
At which point the judge sentenced them to 5 years despite the fact that it was no longer a mandatory minimum. Now, that was my understanding. I'm not saying I don't have any reason to believe that it's correct.
Yeah, I don't know anything about an appeal, but by no means am I someone who spent time studying the legal aspects of the case. I don't know what it was that got the case in front of a different judge to where that judge said, oh yeah, 4 months, a year, that wasn't enough. You're going to go in for 5 years total, so report back to prison.
Well, you see, that's the thing, is unless they're on probation and he violates their probation, the original, what you originally described doesn't pass the smell test with me, because I don't believe there's any mechanism in the legal system to make somebody, like, you know, I don't know any way that
it's
they
crazy.
Could just call me back in and
they can,
without
like
proving something additional, say, yeah, we want you to serve another 10 years for selling that weed.
I don't think
they can do
I
it.
I think that they can. It's basically the equivalent of a motion to reconsider in the state's favor. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733, and you can join us here also via Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. Free Talk Live.
When we ran out, we stopped using it.
Why would you stop?
Why undo all the good that's been accomplished? We thought everything was fine, and that was not a good thing.
No.
He started stinking. It was awful.
Shedding comes back. Loss of hair, lots of dandruff.
Scratching will return. His shedding will increase.
If I ever took Roy off of Dinovite, he would go back to his hair loss.
DINOVITE.com.
859-428-1000.
When I get down to the bottom of my box of Dinovite,
when I get to about 3/4,
oh no, I've got a couple more scoops.
It's time to place my order.
Dinovite.com.
Each and every day she is getting a Dinovite.
The omega-3 fatty acids.
Flaxseed, zinc, alfalfa.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
Just feed your dog right. Use Dinovite. If it's working, don't quit.
Don't do what I did and run out.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
DINOVITE.com.
Winter has just begun, and are you already tired of being cold? How would you like to never be cold again? This is Dale with Fortress Clothing, and I'm here to tell you, you will never be cold again with Fortress. If you're tired of freezing your butt off, elk hunting, sitting in a tree stand, deer hunting, winter camping, fishing, ice fishing, no longer fear the cold. If you snowmobile, ski, snowboard, get Fortress. Sledding with the kids, shoveling the walks, shopping, or if you or your spouse get cold feet at home, get Fortress. If you're stuck outside working in the cold or find yourself in an emergency situation, get our winter bug out bag and you will never be cold again. Fortress is the answer, so quit complaining and go to fortressclothing.com. It's a mid-layer garment that goes with anything you want to wear. Enter coupon code radio and get 20% off any item. Go now while we still have inventory. FortressClothing.com.
Every once in a while, you get information that's worth changing your life for. This is one such time. You can save up to and beyond 25% on all purchases at Amazon. You probably heard of Bitcoin and just not thought much about it. You certainly know that you can get competitive pricing at Amazon, but now you can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need to live. I've just given you a huge raise, and all you have to do is claim it. You go to saveitpurse.com and open an account. Do this right now. Don't wait. Then you fund the account with Bitcoin. I know this sounds unbelievable, but at my house, we saved as much as 45% off of a new item on Amazon. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to saveitpurse.com right now, get signed up, and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 15 to 25% off of everything at Amazon through saveatpurse.com. It's saveatpurse.com.
LRN.fm is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for LRN.fm in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate us 5 stars, then share the link on your social media and let your friends and family know how you're listening to LRN.fm. Download it now, free, at apps.lrn.fm.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading on Thursday, gold is $1 lower at $1,063 per ounce. Silver is even at $13.93 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $423. Our offices are closed this week for year-end processes and to enjoy the holidays with family and friends, but you can still shop our online store at rrbi.co for some of the best deals you'll find on silver and gold. rrbi.co.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live, and you can join us here toll-free, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We also have Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. We're going to continue. We'll take your calls here. The Oregon, I don't know if it's called a standoff yet. I'm not sure how many federal agents are actually on the scene at this wildlife reserve.
I haven't heard about any federal agents being there. I know that the place was empty and unused.
Well, that was over the weekend.
They showed up.
That was over the weekend, so maybe it's not empty all the time. Maybe it was just empty for the weekend.
I got the impression it was closed for the season.
Oh, you might be right about that. All right, so we're going to learn more about this as time goes on. We're going to take your calls as well. You're also welcome to join us online at freetalklive.com. Ian and Rich in the studio as normal on a Monday night, but also Joel Valenzuela from rightsbrigade.com is here tonight. We'll talk more about Rights Brigade and what's been going on there, because the jury outreach we haven't really even touched on yet, and I think that's pretty big what you've done there. But first, let's go to Hung Like Jesus. He's on Skype.
I was drinking tea when you said that.
You're on Free Talk Live. That's his name. Go ahead.
That's okay. I laughed for you.
Okay. Hello, guys.
Hey.
I just want you to follow me here, because it's going to be clear where I'm going, but I'm just going to use a hypothetical. Let's say a group of, Muslims, brown Muslims, Americans, though, was having a problem with the local post office. Their mail wasn't getting delivered the way it should have been getting delivered. Say the mailman was just throwing it on the ground or whatever. They had a problem with the mail delivery. And they got together and, they said, well, let's go down here and let's take over this post office and see if we can't get something done. How long, before you think the SWAT team would roll in there and bodies start piling up?
Yeah, that's a good question. I guess it would just depend on how things were going. I mean, in the case in Oregon, you don't actually have anyone being held hostage. No one has had guns pointed at them at this point. So, I guess it would depend on how they handled things in the post office.
There's definitely
you could take a group of Muslims unarmed, just and they're just garb unarmed, and go and just try to persuade whoever's in charge of this post office to, do things correctly. Say a shouting match starts. Someone calls the cops. They come, they see a group of people dressed like what Muslims would be dressed like. It would be hell, and we know it, and we know this to be the case.
Well, I don't know. I'm not going to jump to a conclusion about that. I mean, we know that as far as
certainly bad things have happened to in cases where black people and minorities have been out protesting.
Sure, I mean fire hoses back in the 60s.
Yeah, so I definitely won't say that it can't happen, but I don't think it's 100% race. I mean, people have been saying, why haven't they gone in and attacked these people who are in Idaho?
Oregon.
Oregon, I'm sorry. And you know, well, the first thing is that they really haven't broken a law, as far as I know. They're protesting, and so they're exercising their First Amendment rights, and they're carrying weapons, so they're exercising their Second Amendment rights. But I'm not sure what law, if any, they've violated. But
I'm sure there must be a trespassing charge in there somewhere.
Could be. If
well,
it's
maybe,
true
except my understanding is that you're allowed to camp on this wildlife refuge.
Right. So let's just say no laws are being broken. They're just protesting. Okay, we'll go with that one. Now, let's look back on the protests in recent times here. Just protest. Let's go back to when the thing happened in Ferguson, when they initially started the protest, it looked like the military was out there.
Sure, no doubt about it.
It was going to be nothing going to happen here unless you could get through this militarized police force.
I think there's also a scope sort of thing. I mean, the sheer amount of protesters there must have been a little bit intimidating. That doesn't at all excuse any kind of militarized action for that. But also, there might have been a sort of assumption that at some point later on, another group might cause some sort of property damage or violence that then would sort of justify preemptively rolling out the troops, so to speak.
You can dance around it, and you know, and we can play little word games. But the bottom line is, if this was black people out there doing what these people are doing right now, you can best believe it would have been put to a stop yesterday.
What I would tell you is, yes, they violate the rights of black people too. And frankly, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying there's no racism in law enforcement. There's a hell of a lot of racism in law enforcement. But it's a lot of people look at things. They don't look at whether the people are right or wrong. They look at who the people are. And here's an example of that. There are people that I know that were calling for violence against the Ferguson protesters who are now justifying what's going on in Oregon. And on the other side, there are people who were who said the actions of the Ferguson protesters were okay, but are now calling for the deaths of these people in Oregon. So it's not a matter of what they did. It's just a matter of who they are. Now, what I say is they had a right to protest in Ferguson. They had a right to protest in New York at Occupy Wall Street, which you will see there was definitely white kids at Occupy Wall Street, but they did get brutalized on a regular basis
because they
were unarmed.
Right. They cracked down on Wall Street as well. And I think that's an important point to bring up here is in the scenario of the takeover at the post office, you were saying that they were unarmed in that scenario. And I think that, you know, in that case, yes, the police are going to come in and they're going to swoop in and they're going to do something about it, just like they would with a sit-in. But in this case, you're talking about people who have guns, and the police behave in a much more cautious manner when people are, you know, are carrying weapons. It changes how they behave. Yeah. Plus, you're also talking about something happening out in the middle of nowhere, as opposed to in a city type area. City cops are going to behave differently than, you know, the cops out in the woods kind of cops. It's just a reality. Would it change something if they were all black?
There's another thing there. Another group that I have supported, and some of my friends in the gun rights movement have said I was wrong to do it, but they have exactly the same rights that I have. The New Black Panthers did go marching through Texas with guns, and many of them, I believe, are Muslims. And as far as I know, they were left alone. Well, why? Because those cops want to go home. This is why we have a Second Amendment. Everybody protesting should be bringing guns to their protests, along with pitchforks and torches. Because if you bring guns to your protests, the police do not want a pitched battle with protesters, and you have a Second Amendment right to keep and bear arms. Now, one of the big purposes of the drug war was to criminalize as many black people as possible so that they could no longer exercise that Second Amendment right.
That's true.
If you read Malcolm X on guns, he is very clear, and he is very much down with the idea idea that people need to be prepared to defend themselves. And I think that the New Black Panthers and the people in Oregon have done an excellent job of demonstrating why.
Free Talk Live.
Hunters, anglers, campers, and survivalists, get back to nature. Expand your horizons with the highest quality, most versatile, unique slingshots and sling bows on the market at slingbow.com. Slingbow products are compact and models start from just $17.98. They're perfect for your bug out bag or storing
and, you
in your vehicle.
Give
yourself and your loved ones the excitement and tradition of slingbow, a new frontier in archery and truly modern twist on this primitive survival tool. Feel the thrill only at slingbow.com. So you've got to take a state construction license exam or certification. Can't decide on what books or what chapters to study? Discover right now how you can eliminate unnecessary books and wasted study time. At contractorexam.com, our study materials zero in on state-required test topics in an effective, multiple-choice format. So whether you're a plumber, electrician, general contractor, or other construction-related trade, contractorexam.com will help get you prepared. Visit us at www.contractorexam.com today.
Money, power, and respect are all yours at CreditSuccessSecretsRevealed.com. Be seen as an industry leader. You can do it. The last application you filled out when it was time to hit submit, did your nerves spike? You didn't get the approval you seek, but there's a better way. We teach you exactly what to place into the right systems the right way the first time so you get approved. Get up to $100,000 in instant business credit. Many people will get cash on the spot. Use those two tools in your new corporate credit engine so you can walk into the bank and get your project funded today. It's all about today at CreditSuccessSecretsRevealed.com. Credit Success Secrets Revealed is explosive and ignites instant results. Dial 1-800-707-8719. That's 1-800-707-8719. 1-800-707-8719. Or just go to CreditSuccessSecretsRevealed.com.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Understanding your credit score is the first step towards managing and improving it. This is Charlie Sundstrom with your Van Dyke Mortgage Minute. The most influential component of your credit score is your payment history. Almost equally as important is the amount you owe on credit accounts. Also impacting your score, but to a lesser degree, are the length of time you've utilized your credit, the number of new accounts, credit inquiries, and your various types of credit accounts. To help achieve or maintain a healthy credit score, have a system set up to assure your bills are always paid on time. Don't max out your cards. It's better to have a high credit limit with a low balance. Never close old accounts. The age of these can actually help your credit score. But don't be afraid to use your credit. You need several accounts in order to have a credit score. Just keep the corresponding payments within your means. For your mortgage pre-approval and refi needs, start by visiting VanDykeMortgage.com.
Corporate NMLS 3035. Van Dyke Mortgage is an equal housing lender. Charlie Sundstrom, NMLS 134251.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
Free Talk Live. Join us here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Or Skype into the show at Skype username lrn.fm. I intended to bring Hung Like Jesus back on to respond because you were on a roll there, Rich, a moment ago, and he disconnected, unfortunately. So.
Well, if you're still out there, Jesus, come back to me because that I enjoyed that conversation. And please, I don't...
I'm not saying that I would never say that action should be taken against people who are peacefully protesting anywhere. You know, that's not the case. I'm just very concerned that people like Montel Williams, who I really respected when he said that if Trump were elected, he would take out a gun and stand up for the rights of Muslims. But then he turns around and he's calling for these protesters to be massacred when it's not clear whether they've done anything beyond trespass. You know, and it's like that kind of thing is heartbreaking,
yeah,
because
crazy.
I hear a celebrity say, I will take up arms against the government if the government is wrong. And I'm like, yes, yes. And then he comes back with something like that. And I'm like, dude,
that's because
dude,
the caveat is it's not if the government is wrong, is if the government or anyone disagrees with me. It's an ideological thing.
Well, that gets into my idea that really what we need to do is dissolve the federal government and have 50 states and let each 50
yes.
each of the 50 states decide how they're going to do those things, and you know, even split some of the states. I mean, Florida could be split into North and South Florida. Of course, I think North Florida would be the coastal regions and South Florida would be the interior. So that would be very strange. But if you've ever lived in Florida,
yes,
you get that.
Let's go to the phones here. Tim is on the line in Wyoming. You're on Free Talk Live, listening online. Hey, Tim.
Hey, gents. How you doing
tonight? Hey, go ahead, sir.
And happy New Year, too.
Thanks.
And also, now I'm reading Article 5 of the, Fifth Amendment. Of the Constitution here. No person shall be held to answer for a capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on a present. Okay, I'll just skip ahead here. Nor shall any person be subject for the same offense to be put twice or to be twice put in jeopardy of life or limb.
Yeah, double jeopardy.
That's exactly what we're pardon?
Double jeopardy, as it's called in the legal land.
Double jeopardy is exactly it. The reason I'm reading it is because that's exactly what's happening now. I mean, that's a total abridgment of the freedoms of the people who not only are, as you said, as you gentlemen have been saying, I mean, as everyone knows, first, second, and I mean, all the amendments to the Constitution and their personal freedom and rights for themselves. But they're also, I mean, the reason that the Oath Keepers and whatnot are up there in Oregon and they're saying stand down, but
Oath Keepers didn't go and they encouraged people not to go, but continue with
yeah,
your
I thought
point.
I thought I heard the Oath Keeper head boss man, Stuart Rhodes, I believe is his name.
Yeah, I went to their website. They've got a statement out there saying we shouldn't be there because the Hammonds don't want us there, so don't go. And
okay,
I think that's
okay.
why it's so small compared to what it would have been, I think, if
okay.
it's really unclear whether the Bundys were right to move when they did, even though I agree with you that the Hammonds got screwed. They never should have gone to jail in the first place. They certainly shouldn't have gone on a terrorism charge.
Right. Well, I mean, they were just trying to protect their own property with a backfire. Originally, I mean, the first and second time were both 2001 and 2006. They were both backfires to protect their property, which borders federal land. I mean, they use some federal land for grazing, but at the same time, they're trying to protect the rest of their land by not letting it get burned up by lightning strikes or whatever the fire. I mean, one was a lightning strike. I can't remember what the other one was, but
consider the situation if this wasn't federal land, if it was just a neighboring rancher's land, and if there was some sort of damages, there would be possibly some sort of settlement. It would not
and
go
that'd be
to
it.
Yeah, it would be that would be it. It wouldn't be a
yeah.
huge criminal arson. Oh my gosh, like there wouldn't be lives destroyed over what it looks like to be a simple mistake, and there wouldn't be hundreds of armed people rising up to protest some poor rancher getting mad that some of their land got burned.
And there's a lot more than that going on here as well. There's a pattern, as I understand it, the central allegation of the Bundys and the reason that the Bundys are way up there is that there is a concerted effort going on to steal ranches in the American West.
It's been going on for decades,
and add them to wildlife refuges I don't know how to pronounce that word right now, apparently. But
refuges,
and add them to to federal land management projects for reasons that are really unclear. I don't know why the federal government owns a third of the land in the western United States. I have no idea what possible constitutional purpose there is for that in the first place.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Okay, let me jump in there on a second because I have a personal story. So I grew up on a ranch in the north of Mexico. And at one point during that time, the Mexican government declared a biosphere in that region and ordered all ranchers in the area to surrender their property and leave with no compensation.
Wow.
This is not the first time they had done this. They did it successfully before, but the denizens of that area were mostly uneducated, illiterate peasants that had no choice but to leave, and they were left destitute. No compensation. But luckily, in this area where my family lived, a lot of the ranchers there were very educated and fairly well off, and they mounted resistance to this. And I remember growing up going to all these hearings about the issue, and over time they got pushed back and they backed off the biosphere, and the ranchers are still there to this day. But I know exactly what it's like, and they had received funding from I believe the U.S. federal government had given Mexico a grant to push these sort of biospheres.
Wow.
Now, I don't know. I'm not going to start going conspiracy mode about that, but that's just what happened.
Were they armed? I don't know what gun laws
it's
are like in Mexico.
It's illegal to have guns in Mexico.
Yes.
It's illegal to do a lot of things that happen in Mexico.
It was a legal battle, not an armed battle. But it was, there's always that. Most landowners in the North of Mexico are, in fact, very heavily armed, even though it's not. There's laws saying you can own a firearm on your property, but you cannot transport it. So it makes it so it's legally impossible to bring
to
firearms.
Get it to your property.
But if it's on your, it's a little bit of a tricky situation. But however it works, thankfully there was no armed resistance involved or even implicitly threatened. But of course it could have come to that, and there was international attention. A good thing is part of it is my family used to own a newspaper in the United States before becoming cattle ranchers, and so they're dealing with media experts, and there was a good cause to sort of back off when it's not an illiterate peasant trying to stand up for their rights.
Tim, further thoughts? Go ahead.
What I was going to say is, well, as far as the firearms and firearms transfer in Mexico, I mean, if the U.S. federal government had decided to send them down there, it'd probably be okay. But that's kind of a joke, but not really. But no, what I was going to say is you're right about the oath keepers, but as far as what they're doing up there, I mean, I understand they were standing up for the rights of two individuals who decided not to stand up for themselves. That's the reason they did that, and that's the reason that the Bundys decided to join the fight. I mean, basically go to battle for someone else. That's what they did, and that's what they're doing. But in the case of their
and
own,
I think that's a point. I think that's a good thing to do for folks is to stand up for others' rights. But when the person asks you not to do it, I think that you should probably stand down at that point. I don't know.
Or at least admit you have a different objective.
And the person who is getting pulled over or getting arrested asks me to leave, I'm going to turn around and leave.
So will I.
Because I'm not going to make his condition worse or frighten him that I will by staying. I'm going to let him play it his way.
The only time that I generally will follow that rule, and thanks for the call, Tim. The only time I'll break from that rule is if I'm around and I see somebody being arrested and manhandled by the police, I will record that no matter what they, you know, what they say about it, because that's happening in public and people need to see that. The police need to be recorded in those instances. It's Free Talk Live.
Think you're fat? You might just be bloated. Find out by calling now for a free trial of Nubiotics, the new breakthrough that flattens bloated bellies fast. For a free trial, call 1-800-965-1170.
I used to be plagued by pot belly and constant bloating. After taking Nubiotics, my belly flattened and continues to get flatter. My sense of bloating and discomfort is gone.
If you've got a big belly, you might not be fat. You might just be bloated. Nubiotics is scientifically formulated with natural ingredients to flatten bloated bellies fast by cleansing pounds of rotting food and toxic sludge from your body. It even combats periodic heartburn and acid reflux. So just think how much better you'll look and feel. Think you might be bloated? Call now for a free trial of Nubiotics and see how much flatter it makes your belly. You might be surprised, but hurry, call now for details while these free trials last. 1-800-965-1170. That's 1-800-965-1170. 1-800-965-1170.
Don't complain about your cable bill going up and up and up. Do something about it. Grab a pencil and jot down this special number. 1-855-905-MY-TV. The more cable TV rates go up, the better digital satellite TV looks. Say goodbye to the cable guy and get more of your favorite channels in 100% digital quality for less money. Call 1-855-905-MY-TV. Sign up for packages starting as low as $19.99, and there's no equipment to buy. You get free HD TV upgrade, a free DVR upgrade, and free professional installation. You control what you watch, when you watch it. Record your favorite shows, pause and rewind live TV, even skip the commercials. Watch local channels too. At just $19.99, what are you waiting for? Pull out your major credit or debit card. Call 1-855-905-MYTV. 1-855-905-MYTV. Say goodbye to the cable guy. Cut costs and get more. 1-855-905-MYTV. 1-855-905-MYTV.
An unpopular police officer thinks about committing a racially motivated offense for a little support. A middle-aged man is having the best snacks of his life, and a housefly drops everything to go stand on a watermelon slice. This is the Onion Week in Review. Noting the youth center's ping pong table and array of DVDs and Blu-rays, local youth minister Mark Kindler told reporters this week that his church's new rec room has everything a teen could want. The youth pastor revealed that the basement facility's many teen-friendly amenities include a new Wii U console, an iPod dock for the teens to play any music they like, and some comfortable recliners for those who just want to relax or do their homework after school.
We've really gone out of our way to give the rec room a laid-back atmosphere. It's stocked with snacks, but sometimes at the end of the week, we'll spring for some pizza. Honestly, I wish I had a place like this when I was their age.
In other news, increased violence leads the State Department to issue an advisory for Americans traveling to 1861, and an elderly lobbyist is always droning on about how little legislation used to cost in his day.
This is the Onion News Network.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com. Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross has been sentenced to life in prison with no possibility of parole. Now, an appeal is Ross's only chance, and he needs your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Join us right here. The toll-free number for you is 855-450-FREE. We also have Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. Coming up in less than a couple months, like month and a half at this point, the Liberty Forum is on deck at Manchester's New Hampshire Radisson Hotel. It's right on basically Main Street. It's not called Main Street, but it is. It's Elm Street in Manchester. It is in the heart of downtown Manchester. It's a great location to have a convention of hundreds of liberty-minded folks. Joel, are you going to be attending this year at Liberty Forum?
I believe so.
I think we'll all probably end
I'll be up, there with bells on.
Yeah, being at Liberty Forum. In fact, Free Talk Live is going to be broadcasting live every single night from the event. Edward Snowden is...
Yeehaw.
Yeah, Edward Snowden. That Edward Snowden, the one who released all of the damning information about the NSA back in 2013, he's going to be the keynote speaker, one of the keynote speakers. I don't believe they've announced any of the other keynotes yet, and I suspect they will announce at least one more. So stay tuned for more details on who's speaking. But Edward Snowden, you probably don't need much more reason to attend. But another good reason would be that you'll be around hundreds of people who care about freedom, and you can get a taste for what it's like to live here in New Hampshire, to move here as part of the Free State Project, an experience of that community that exists here that does not exist anywhere else to the extent that it exists here. Yeah, there's a few libertarians in Austin, and there's a few here and there in, you know, bigger cities, but we've got more libertarians.
They will be assimilated.
I think we have more libertarians in this building right now. We're you know, we're in just a house, basically a duplex, where we're producing this show. We have more libertarians living here than I think came to the average Libertarian Party meeting in Sarasota, Florida, where I'm from. And then if you count the house across the street, which is also owned by Free Staters, now we're talking about probably more libertarians in two houses right next door to one another than were completely active in Sarasota, Florida, across, you know, in a city of 500,000 people. So we've got a...
And this is an outpost behind enemy lines in probably the least friendly city in New Hampshire.
It's true.
To libertarian ideas. We're the ones who came to preach to the unreformable.
Yeah, I like how you describe it, an outpost beyond enemy lines. That's pretty good. And there's a lot more people in Manchester and Concord starting to grow with this new club that's open there, Area 23. There's a lot more kind of gatherings going on. You were at the
Area 23 is beautiful.
Yeah, it's a great. It's actually a publicly accessible bar. It's
and that was one of their big goals in opening it, was to provide a place where the average person off the street would show up, as well as the hardcore liberty activist, and they'd have some meaningful, friendly conversations over a beer.
Right. The you know, if an average Joe comes into this bar that's run by Free Staters and frequented by Free Staters and other liberty-minded folks in New Hampshire, then odds are real good that anyone with whom he strikes up a conversation, Mr. Average Joe, will be talking to someone who understands very, very well the ideas of liberty and can communicate them. So I think it's a cool thing that they're doing up there. And actually, you and I were both there for the New Year's Eve party, Joel. So come up and experience what it's like to be around hundreds of people who care about freedom at the Liberty Forum, February 18th through the 21st. So that is going to be here before you know it. And that's a Thursday through a Sunday, so a full weekend right in the heart of wintertime here in New Hampshire. And it has gotten cold. It was nice and kind of warm throughout December. It has gotten cold as of this month. February 18th through the 21st. Go to nhlibertyforum.com. You can grab your tickets there and book your hotel, nhlibertyforum.com. I'm looking forward to it. It's always... I think a must-attend event. The Porcupine Freedom Festival is also a must-attend event, but this one's another one, and I think it's as important as Porkfest. So you can join us here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. There's more to say about the situation in Oregon, and then I think we can come back around to some of the outreach projects that you've been involved with here, Joel, in New Hampshire, specifically jury outreach and your thing of Rights Brigade, which we'll get back to. But the situation in Oregon continues to develop at the wildlife refuge, the Malheur Federal Wildlife Refuge, where as few as 15, as many as 150, I still have yet to see a better estimate of how many people are involved in this situation, have taken
over. I've heard 25 and I've heard 150, so that's a wide variance, sixfold.
So, you know, we're learning more as time goes on. And one of the things that's been disturbing over the last day on this has been the call for violence. You touched on it earlier, Rich, from Montel Williams, who should know a thing or two about state violence, as he is a medical marijuana user. We actually have a commercial that runs on the airwaves.
Wow.
Yeah, we have a commercial that runs on LRN.FM that he voiced for the Marijuana Policy Project. And he talks about medical marijuana and how it helps him and, you know, how terrible prohibition is, basically. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you get it on that issue, Montel, but to demand that these people who have not used any violence on anyone whatsoever be, you know, killed or attacked physically by the feds.
Yes, I've even heard a lot of very progressive folk advocating for specifically drone bombing them.
Wow, that's crazy.
I've heard this many times, and that's it's not just...
I thought that was a joke. That's for real?
That's for real. People are actually advocating for that.
Wow.
And that's it's not just that it's sort of a hypocrisy when you're trying to go for an anti-war angle in other ways, but then just quickly turn on violence right here. But just,
well, not all lefties are anti-war.
Exactly. Well,
Barack Obama.
Exactly. That's
And Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. But it's interesting to see even using the same rhetoric. The same people that were defending every single refugee trying to escape their war-torn country into the United States. The same person, the same people trying to downplay any sort of shying away from any kind of terrorism allegations, instantly throw it on with the fullest seriousness against these protesters in Oregon. It's kind of interesting to see how there isn't even an attempt to sort of finesse that outright call for blatant violence.
If you want to join us here, toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. The Washington Post's Janelle Ross writes a piece entitled, "Why Aren't We Calling the Oregon Occupiers Terrorists?" She says, as of Sunday afternoon, Washington Post called them occupiers. The New York Times opted for armed activists and militiamen. And the Associated Press put the situation this way, quote, "A family previously involved in a showdown with the federal government has occupied a building at a national wildlife refuge in Oregon and is asking militia members to join them," unquote. No one seemed to lean towards terms such as insurrection, revolt, and anti-government insurgents, or as some on social media were calling them, terrorists. Now, generally, you know, insurrection.
Don't you have to do something before you become a terrorist?
Terrorize,
I think
maybe.
You have to use some violence, right?
Or at least threaten it, right?
Yeah, at the very least threaten it. And so far, these people have only threatened to use defensive violence. So they have, some of them have said that if they are attacked, that they will shoot in response. And they have had this sort of mentality of, and I'm saying they, only the ones I've seen speaking, right? So
sure.
There's a bunch of them there. So there's this one guy who's like a former Marine. We played a little of his YouTube video that he posted off the air yesterday because it was way too long. It was like 14 minutes of him sitting in his SUV getting ready to go to this place, leaving a message for his family, basically. And it sounded very much like, you know, he was not expecting to come home alive from this situation. So, you know, there has definitely the situation has definitely been sort of tinged with the "we're putting our foot down, we're willing to die for this" rhetoric, but that's a lot different than holding someone hostage or threatening violence, aggressive violence against another human being. And I would say that you need to have that typically for an insurrection, a revolt, an insurgency, and terrorism. I mean, I think all of those words are too strong for what has gone on here. Had they gone in and held someone hostage in this particular federal government building, then I think that you'd be more adept to use those terms.
Yeah, I mean, they use insurgents to describe people in Iraq who are trying to defend their country against an occupying force. So I guess you could say that the ranchers in Oregon are trying to defend their country against an occupying force in the form of the federal government. But they're not doing it by force.
Yeah, they're not building IEDs.
In my mind,
I would certainly be willing to die to free us from the federal government. I just don't think that dying now would have that effect.
No.
So I think they are premature in taking up arms if they actually go to the point of fighting. But right now, all they've done is gotten a lot of free publicity at very little cost and legal risk. So I think they've just done a brilliant job of promoting their cause.
Yeah, the whole term terrorism has been really bandied around a lot and hasn't really applied to true terrorism very often. For example, to my mind, at least, it would necessitate harming or threatening harm upon innocents, like civilians, non-combatants, in order to spread terror. And if you have a force, for one thing, that's not even engaging civilians at all, I think that label should absolutely be dropped.
This is Free Talk Live, 855-450-FREE.
You can control your health care with Liberty HealthShare.
Liberty HealthShare is like-minded people coming together to share medical costs, which saves money.
You don't even have to pay for procedures that violate your conscience.
Because we all share the same values.
Join the movement of people who share in medical costs and change the way you pay for your health care forever.
Go to libertyhealthshare.org to find out more.
Liberty HealthShare.
Together, we're changing healthcare for good. LibertyHealthShare.org.
Currency is too important a thing to be left in the hands of government bureaucrats, especially when billions of dollars can be created with the swipe of a pen. Overstock.com supports the cryptocurrency movement because it returns the power of an inflation-proof form of money to the people, where it belongs. Did you know that you can use Bitcoin to pay for anything Overstock.com sells while enjoying free shipping on orders of 0.211 Bitcoin or more? If you support freedom and the cryptocurrency movement, you should support Overstock.com. So you've signed the Shire Society Declaration and are planning your move to New Hampshire to be around more liberty-oriented people. Next, sign up for the Shire Society Forum at forum.shiresociety.com. There are a bunch of people there who are already in the Shire, and they want to meet you. If you're already in the Shire physically, you should also come by the forums. Remember, not everyone uses Facebook. New people are signing up for the Shire Society Forum every month, so drop in and say hello at forum.shiresociety.com.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, January 4th, 2016. Silver is trading at $13.89 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,064 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $432. Antiwar.com reports after 9 days of more or less constant airstrikes against targets inside Yemen, Saudi Arabia announced on Sunday that they are abandoning their ceasefire in Yemen and that it is because the Shiite Houthis are violating the terms. The ceasefire was initially meant to facilitate peace talks, though fighting never really slowed down, and indeed, Saudi-backed forces occupied several cities over the course of the 9-day period. The peace talks ended without any real progress. It is unclear what, if any, differences there will be in the Yemen war without the ceasefire, though it will likely mean the Saudis won't feel the need to publicly blame the Houthis every time they unilaterally launch an airstrike on a city. In talking up the Houthi violations, the Saudis cited missiles fired from Yemen into Saudi territory. Such strikes have happened off and on throughout the war, killing a handful of people.
For nearly 40 years, Roberts & Roberts Brokerage has been a trusted source for buying and selling precious metals like gold and silver. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and have permanently removed the minimum purchase amount for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on buying and selling precious metals and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 800-874-9760 or visit online at rrbi.co.
UPI reports an armed group has seized control of a federal building in Oregon to protest alleged unconstitutional action by the U.S. government after holding a rally showing support for ranchers convicted of arson. The incident began in the town of Burns, Oregon, where protesters were voicing support for Dwight Hammond and his son Stephen, who were convicted of arson in 2012 and served time in prison, but whose sentences a court later ruled were too short. The men were scheduled to turn themselves in on Monday to serve 5 years in prison. Dwight Hammond said he and his son are planning to peacefully report to prison despite the protest. After the rally on Saturday, the protesters broke into the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge's unoccupied government building less than 30 miles away and refused to leave. The group said it could possibly stay in the compound for years and may use violence if authorities attempt to evict them. Ammon Bundy, a spokesman for the group, told CNN, "We will be here as long as it takes. We have no intentions of using force upon anyone, but if force is used against us, we would defend ourselves." Some in the local community disagree with the group's steps, calling them a militia. Ammon Bundy is the son of Cliven Bundy, a Nevada rancher who gained international attention in 2014 after staging an armed standoff with federal authorities over a grazing dispute with the Bureau of Land Management. Ammon Bundy said they will be bringing the lands up and getting the ranchers back to ranching, the miners back to mining, putting the loggers back to logging, where they can do it under the protection of the people and not be afraid of this tyranny that has been upon them. In the arson case, the Hammonds said they lit the fires to reduce the growth of invasive species and protect their lands from wildfires.
Are you an advocate for free market money? Do you promote Bitcoin as an alternative in a fiat-centric world? Then you need Spendabit in your arsenal. The search engine for things you can buy with Bitcoin. Spendabit aggregates millions of products from thousands of Bitcoin-enabled merchants. Keep your money in the free economy. Visit spendabit.co today. Bitcoin merchants, ask about our merchant suite to reach even more customers. Spendabit.co.
Reuters reports New York Governor Andrew Cuomo signed an executive order on Sunday requiring local officials throughout the state to force the homeless into shelters when temperatures dip below freezing and vowed to defend the edict if challenged in court. The order, which takes effect on Tuesday, requires social service agencies and police to move homeless individuals into shelters against their will if necessary when the temperature is at or below 32 degrees Fahrenheit, 0 degrees Celsius. The order also requires shelters to extend hours of operation to ensure that homeless people can stay inside whenever there is inclement winter weather, which can cause hypothermia, serious injury, and death. According to the order, state law allows for the involuntary placement of homeless individuals so they do not cause harm to themselves or others. Officials at the Coalition for the Homeless Advocacy Group in New York City could not be reached for comment. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Captain Actual America is overweight and hopelessly in debt, and the Richie Rich comic strip introduces a new, even gayer character. As if you needed another reason to remain in your isolated and socially degenerative cocoon, this is the Onion Week in Review, Comics Edition. Sources confirmed Tuesday that the comic book and sci-fi expo Comic-Con was once again marred by BullyCon, an increasingly popular event held in the same convention space. Now in its fifth year, BullyCon reportedly drew more than 125,000 tormentors from across the nation, all of whom were bent on beating up and torturing those attending the many comic book, television, and movie panels at Comic-Con.
This got started, it was just a couple of friends who wanted to beat the shit out of some Joss Whedon fans, but now there are thousands of us ruining Walking Dead panels, taunting Harry Potter nerds, and really making some video gamers' lives completely miserable. I don't necessarily need to travel to San Diego to slap a copy of Spider-Man out of some pussy's hands, but something really special about coming together with people who dig the same sort of cruelty you do.
Free Talk Live.
This is Free Talk Live. You can join us here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Washington Post asking, why aren't we calling the Oregon occupiers terrorists?
Because they're not.
Yeah, because they haven't used violence or threatened initiatory force on anyone. But we'll continue with that because we've only given the Washington Post editorial staff here a moment. Only a few sentences in here. I want to get into a little more of it. And then we'll talk about Rights Brigade. It's Ian and Rich in the studio. Joel Valenzuela is joining us here from rightsbrigade.com. He's an early mover as part of the Free State Project. And we'll talk more about some of the cool stuff that's going on here in New Hampshire that is only going to get better as thousands more people move here as part of the Free State Project. So if you've yet to check out the Free State Project and you care about the ideas of freedom, if you understand that in order to be free, you have to allow others to be free, then you should join us here. Go to freestateproject.org. As we continue here, Janelle Ross over at the Washington Post has said that the media has been describing the people in Oregon that are occupying a federal wildlife reserve. There's a building on that premises, I guess, the Malheur Federal Wildlife Reserve that they're occupying, and some of them are armed. They've been called armed activists, militiamen, occupiers, and the lady here at the Washington Post says that, well, why aren't they talking about them as though they are insurgents or terrorists? She says, quote, when a group of unknown size and unknown firepower has taken over any federal building with plans and possibly some equipment to aid a years-long occupation, and when its representative tells reporters they would prefer to avoid violence but are prepared to die, the kind of almost uniform delicacy and the limits on the language used to describe the people involved becomes noteworthy itself. It's hard to imagine, she says, that none of the words mentioned above, particularly insurrection or revolt, would be avoided if, for instance, a group of armed black Americans took possession of a federal or state courthouse to protest the police. Black Americans outraged about the death of a 12-year-old boy at the hands of police or concerned about the absence of a conviction in the George Zimmerman case have frequently been described or inaccurately lumped together with criminals and looters described as thugs or marauding wolf packs where drugs are, according to CNN's Don Lemon.
And I will tell you, I've been disappointed that a lot of people on the right didn't seem to recognize the Tamir Rice case as a case where an open carrier was shot down in cold blood for exercising his Second Amendment right to have a weapon. Now, in this case, it wasn't a very good weapon. It was just a BB gun. But, you know, if I'm walking down the street with a holstered firearms arm, as I've done many times in the past, and as I hope to do again, I'm hoping that somebody will at least come up and ask me a couple questions before they shoot me in the face.
Well,
so
I don't, in my opinion, I think that it was a ridiculous and unnecessary use of violence in Tamir Rice's case, but I'll go ahead and I'll play the devil's advocate here. Because we did have Chris Cantwell call in, and he was defending the police in that case. He claims that the police say that Tamir Rice was pulling his gun from the waistband, from his waistband, and they had to kill him because of that. That, you know, essentially he could have been drawing on them, and, you know, they don't know if that gun is real or not. And further, it was reported that he wasn't just walking around with a holstered gun. He was allegedly, according to the calls to the police, pointing the gun at people on the streets. So that's brandishing. We don't know what's true in that case, but those were the calls that people made to the police, ostensibly.
Well, having been an open carrier, I will tell you that a lot of the times people make calls to the police that are factually incorrect.
Sure. And he's got a gun!
Yeah. My favorite example of this is I was open carrying in a bar one time, and somebody randomly punched me in the face. And the call that went to the police was, there's a problem in a bar with a man with a gun. Now, basically what I did, because you can't wade into a fist fight when you're carrying a firearm, because your assailant might gain that firearm and be able to harm your friends. So basically what I did is I said, you don't interest me, and walked away. You know, I stood there and shook my head for a minute. He hit me pretty hard. Mm. But, you know, So I get outside, and the next thing you know, I'm looking down the barrel of a police AR-15 pointed in my face. And so I tell him to get the gun out of my face, and he points it at my feet, which is only marginally better. you know, it's...
I was there for that, too.
Yeah, I was actually more irritated at the police than I was at the guy who shot... the guy who hit me.
He was hater. A barfly hater. That guy.
Yeah, I guess he was...
He turned into one of the Stop Free Keeners later on down the line.
Well, I had a feeling. I said to myself, this individual, he's going to go on one day to help found a hate group. So,
yeah, he did.
Exactly.
Join us here. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. She goes on here. The Washington Post... editorial piece. If a group of armed Muslims took possession of a federal building or even its lobby to protest calls to surveil the entire group, it's even more doubtful they could avoid harsher, more alarming labels. In fairness, and I agree with the statement that there will be people online who would certainly call Muslims protesting in that way terrorists, and that would also be inaccurate if they were just simply peacefully carrying guns.
The only thing that would change, and Muslims are kind of a special case, if it was blacks, say it was the new Black Panthers, then the only difference is the right-wing racists would be calling them terrorists, and the left-wing racists would be saying they're not, whereas here you have the left-wing racist saying, oh, these white guys are terrorists, and the white ring racist saying, oh, they're not. And those are the people, you can recognize those people because their estimation of a person's actions is about who they are and not what they did. Those are people who lack principle.
Now, as far as the actual response by government in these kinds of situations, the discrepancy, it seems to be most correlated with what they can get away with.
Yes,
I don't think... And that's my opinion on racism in law enforcement, is it's not so much that they prefer to do bad things to certain groups. It's that they have historically been able to do that and get away with it a lot more.
And they're able to get away with it more on poor people. It's also an economic thing because a poor person is less likely to know their rights, less likely to have an attorney, to have legal counsel. And so they get away with it against poor people more often. And blacks do have more of a poverty. More blacks are in poverty than other.
Yeah. So it can be said it's a socioeconomic thing that tends to overly affect certain ethnic groups.
Toll-free number tonight is 855-450-FREE. More about the Washington Post here and their claims about this is terrorism, they say, or one of their editors or article writers does. We'll go, though, first to Randy in California. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Randy.
Hey, thanks for having me, guys.
Welcome. Go ahead.
I want to talk about the Oregon shooting, but I want to touch on something that you were just talking about regarding
the Oregon shooting.
Who got shot?
Not shooting. I'm sorry. Whatever, a standoff or whatever. I'm just expecting the shooting. But touching on the socioeconomic factors that go into racism or just police beatings. I don't know if you've watched that Making a Murderer documentary on Netflix.
No, I haven't had time for a documentary.
A lot of people have been talking about that lately.
But yeah, someone did call about that.
You gotta watch it, Ian. But it goes into they frame this guy, but he is poor. And when he got this really good attorney, the cops, couldn't believe it because it goes into that how, they don't expect poor people to be able to fight back whenever they do anything.
We got the best justice system that money can buy.
Yeah. Yeah, thank God for taxes. But regarding this whole Oregon standoff, the hypocrisy of it, you guys have been touching on as well. It's just ridiculous with people who, if there's cops are beating people in the streets during a protest. There's people, oh my God, look at the police violence, blah, blah, blah. But I get so angry going on Twitter and everything because now those same people are going, oh, where's the police to kill these guys? Why haven't they shot them? They need to bomb them. And the hypocrisy that goes on is just incredible to me and how just really stupid people are in this country. We don't understand the situation that automatically resort to violence for it is really mind-blowing.
Thanks for your call tonight and the thoughts, Randy. I appreciate it. Our toll-free number for you, if you want to join the discussion, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. It's Free Talk Live.
If you're not a smoker, please cover your ears, because the following incredible free money-saving offer is not for you. The makers of O2 Pure's revolutionary e-cigarette are now giving away free starter kits to all smokers who call in the next 10 minutes. Valued at $99, these starter kits are available for free, but only while supplies last. To guarantee your free kit, simply call in the next 10 minutes. 1-800-691-5458. The advanced O2 Pure design creates a pleasant vapor. There's no foul-smelling smoke and no nasty tar, so you can enjoy the nicotine you love whenever and wherever you are. Even better, you could also save yourself a ton of money, hundreds of dollars a month, with O2 Pure. Again, free starter kits are now available to any smoker who calls in the next 10 minutes. This is a radio-only offer, not available in stores, so call now for your free kit. 1-800-691-5458. 1-800-691-5458. 1-800-691-5458.
Don't complain about your cable bill going up and up and up. Do something about it. Grab a pencil and jot down this special number. 1-855-905-MYTV. The more cable TV rates go up, the better digital satellite TV looks. Say goodbye to the cable guy and get more of your favorite channels in 100% digital quality for less money. Call 1-855-905-MYTV. Sign up for packages starting as low as $19.99 and there's no equipment to buy. You get free HD TV upgrade, a free DVR upgrade, and free professional installation. You control what you watch when you watch it. Record your favorite shows. Pause and rewind live TV. Even skip the commercials. Watch local channels too. At just $19.99, what are you waiting for? Pull out your major credit or debit card. Call 1-855-905-MYTV. 1-855-905-MYTV. Say goodbye to the cable guy. Cut costs and get more. 1-855-905-MYTV. 1-855-905-MYTV.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 90% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. If you're a regular reader of FreeKeene.com, you know there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at FreeKeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at FreeKeene.com. That's FreeKeene.com. So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at LRN.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at LRN.fm. That's LRN.fm.
Why are you playing a slot machine sound for an online poker site?
Do you have a poker sound effect? Because we have a new advertiser, swcpoker.eu.
Brought to you by the same guys that did Seals with Clubs.
Now they're called swcpoker.eu. It's Bitcoin Poker 2.0. They have lots of new games, including Chinese poker. The Krill leaderboard is active now. It's Bitcoin Poker from the brand you trust, swcpoker.eu.
Get on over to swcpoker.eu and start playing now.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You may join us here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. Coming up, we'll talk a little bit more about jury outreach activism that has been amazing here in New Hampshire. And we do have Ian with you tonight.
Rich Paul.
And Joel Valenzuela. Hey, Joel. Welcome.
Hey, how's it going?
Good to have you here from RightsBrigade.com. And we'll come back and talk a little bit more about what you've been doing with Rights Brigade. But a lot of people are still talking, and rightfully so, about what's happening in Oregon. And we're going to continue that with some people saying they should be considered terrorists for peacefully occupying a piece of federal property. Now, they are prepared to do violence, but so far, all of their actions have been relatively peaceful. Maybe, you know, someone broke into the building. I don't know, you know, exactly how many people are inside versus outside. The video I saw earlier today of the same guy who was talking about like he was ready to die yesterday. There was a video that he made. His name's John Ritzheimer, and I apologize.
If you're going to face the police state in any capacity, be prepared to die, even
that's
if
true.
You're not planning on engaging in violence.
Yeah, but that's true. Even peaceful protesters have certainly been shot to death. I mean, back in Ohio, Kent State? That's one example.
Then there was a guy who was shot in the face with a tear gas canister and died in California, I think. No, he didn't die. He was crippled.
There's no shortage of people who've not been violent and been killed by police. So I think you make a good point there, Rich. So we're going to continue with that. But the guy's name is John Ritzheimer. And I apologize because I named him differently yesterday. I had called him Blaine Cooper, and it was a understandable confusion because the YouTube channel the video was posted to was Blaine Cooper's YouTube channel, but the man who was saying goodbye to his family, basically, his name is John Ritzheimer. So I saw another video of him today. This video was of him standing in the Federal Wildlife Refuge area, I think nearby where all this is happening, but he says he's camping out. So it sounds like maybe some people are inside this building perhaps, but others seem to have pitched tents outside the building. And so I don't know, you know, the reports have been that they broke into this building, but we've yet to really see any footage or any evidence of anyone actually inside the building. I'm not saying it's not happening. I just haven't seen that yet. Have you?
I have not, and I would be unsurprised if somebody told me that the Forest Service doesn't always lock the doors of their procedures of their facilities when they happen to be located, you know, within 25 miles of the middle of nowhere.
Could be.
Which is where this place is. That's also, I think, one of the reasons that there hasn't been a panicked response to these people is even if they decided to do something bad, the worst thing they could do would be burn down a log cabin or I suppose start a forest fire,
there's
but
no
that
forest.
Would be crazy.
There's no forest. According to the...
And it's the middle of winter, so forest fire isn't going to do very well either.
But there's not even any trees. Like,
so
there's
are
nothing.
They environmental terrorists or sensibility terrorists? Who or what exactly are they terrorizing in this current situation?
I don't think anyone could claim to have been terrorized by these people. And so we'll get back into that, but I want to let you know about Vistaprint.com. Look, if you need to get business cards made for your business, or as I did, I used Vistaprint to make some Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree palm cards, basically. So they're the size of business cards. They're full color, and they've got the Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree, you know, poster on one side, and then kind of a pitch on the other side for people to go to victimlesscrimespree.com and watch the movie. And it's been great because, you know, if I'm someplace and I want to tell someone about the movie, I don't have to get a piece of paper out and write down the URL for the person. I can just grab one of these cards from my wallet, and Vistaprint made that possible, and they do it really affordably. You can get 500 business cards. And you can completely customize them, customize the text, color, backsides. You can even use fancy upgrades to the cards like metallic, spot gloss, raised print. Plus, they do all kinds of other things, postcards, flyers, banners, apparel, whatever you need for your home-based or small business. Vistaprint can hook you up, and you can use code FTL, like Free Talk Live. It's a special offer just for you because you're a listener of Free Talk Live. Use code FTL at Vistaprint.com. You'll get 500 business cards starting at just $9.99. So it's an incredible price. And again, you can upgrade, so you can pay more if you want, like getting that metallic or spot gloss. It's going to cost you a little bit more there, but 500 business cards starting at just $9.99. And that's an up to 50% savings over the regular site pricing, which is a fantastic deal. There's tons of pre-designed layouts, design options, or you can upload your own design. Maybe you've already got a fancy card all done up and you need to get some more printed. Go through Vistaprint.com, use code FTL. As we continue here from the Washington Post, author Janelle Ross saying she's making the case here, and I think it's a shoddy case, claiming that the people in Oregon should be considered terrorists. Now, she does say, in fairness to those assembled in Oregon, it's true there have been no reports of actual violence, injury, or anyone being held inside the Oregon building against their will. And in the interim, some may feel particularly inclined to take real care with the language used to describe the situation so as not to inflame it or offend people who in some cases have already been troubled by the decision to charge a father and son pair of ranchers with arson under the Anti-Terrorism and Effective Death Penalty Act of 1996. The charge not only carries what many of the ranchers' supporters believe to be an unjust 5-year minimum jail sentence, but it brings the very same T-word, terrorism, into the mix.
Now imagine you're reading that, you know, you get your indictment, your lawyer shows it to you, and you say, oh, what have I been charged? Oh, I've been charged with violating the whatever and death penalty act. What?
Yeah,
what the
exactly.
heck do you mean? I set a fire to protect my land. What's this death penalty?
It's crazy.
Yeah, it really sort of underscores the war on terror's really ugly underside, where not only do you have a couple people charged under as terrorists for something would be just a routine accident in years prior,
sure,
but as we've seen during the response, there's a massive sort of popular pop culture labeling of terrorism on this completely unrelated sort of action. And so I think this is really exposes the over-terrorizing of America, the over-obsession with this concept of terrorism, and now the concept of terrorism seems to be thrust on anything we aren't sort of comfortable with.
I think you're right about that. You've seen it in the media where, you know, people will say, well, is this terrorism, you know, when somebody shoots up a movie theater, or is this terrorism when some other thing happens?
Is it terrorism when they accidentally give me an IPA instead of a lager? I mean, how ridiculous will this get?
If people shoot up a movie theater, terrorism is political violence. People who shoot up
generally,
a school...
Yes.
People who are crazy and shoot up a movie theater, they're not doing terrorism. But then again, I don't know if they got a movie theater in France when it actually was Islamic terrorists, or so we believe, unless it was a false flag attack, that would be for a political purpose. You know, if a bunch of white guys went in and shot up a black church over politics, that would be terrorism. Absolutely.
Well,
or if they shot up a white church over politics, it would be terrorism.
I think we can quibble over this one because, you know, generally terrorism has to do for political purposes, but the definition is the use of violence and threats to intimidate or coerce, comma, especially for political purposes. So it could still be considered terrorism just to terrorize. Not necessarily to have a goal. It's Free Talk Live.
So you've got to take a state construction license exam or certification. Can't decide on what books or what chapters to study? Discover right now how you can eliminate unnecessary books and wasted study time. At contractorexam.com, our study materials zero in on state-required test topics in an effective, multiple-choice format. So whether you're a plumber, electrician, general contractor, or other construction-related trade, contractorexam.com will help get you prepared. Visit us at www.contractorexam.com today.
This is Dan Pilla. Do you owe the IRS money you can't pay? Are tax debts crippling you? I've defended people from the IRS for over 30 years. I've helped thousands, and I can help you too. I wrote the book on IRS settlement, and I'm telling you, there's no such thing as a hopeless case. Call 800-34-NO-TAX to finally get free of IRS debt. With the IRS's new programs, there's never been a better time to solve your problem. Call 800-34-NO-TAX. That's 800-34-NO-TAX or my website, danpilla.com.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. Hey! That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading on Thursday, gold is $1 lower at $1,063 per ounce. Silver is even at $13.93 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $423. Our offices are closed this week for year-end processes and to enjoy the holidays with family and friends, but you can still shop our online store at rrbi.co for some of the best deals you'll find on silver and gold. rrbi.co.
LRN.fm is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for lrn.fm in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate us 5 stars, then share the link on your social media and let your friends and family know how you're listening to lrn.fm. Download it now, free, at apps.lrn.fm.
The warning signs.
First, he made me feel special. He promised he'd look after me, provide for my future. He broke every promise he made.
Millions of Americans afflicted.
I was ready to leave, but he told me he'd change. So I gave him another chance. I was such a fool.
The consequences.
Things only got worse. He started making my decisions for me. About my job, my kids' education, my money, my safety, my future. He took away my choices, but I kept going back to the same politicians.
The diagnosis? Battered voter syndrome.
I fell for the same old lies. They were just playing with my emotions, telling me what I wanted to hear. That's not right.
Stop the insanity of voting for the same old abusers. Declare your independence from the two-party system and join the New Hampshire Liberty Party today at nhliberty.info.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, join us on the radio waves here. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. You can also join us online at freetalklive.com, where you can save 20% or more on your purchases over at Amazon. You go to saveitpurse.com, get started there. The catch is you have to use Bitcoin. We were actually talking off the air, Joel, about Bitcoin and how popular it is here in New Hampshire, at least among the Liberty community. It's still, you know, slowly getting an interest from other folks and, you know, just average people in New Hampshire. But one of the big reasons to use Bitcoin is you can save online. Now, it's cool when a mom and pop store accepts it, and we're starting to see that happen in different places in New Hampshire. But you know, online you can use Bitcoin anywhere at thousands of merchants, and Amazon doesn't themselves accept Bitcoin, so that's why you have to go through saveitpurse.com, because they will help you save big time. And normally the longer or the higher discount you want, because you get to select the discount. 20% is pretty easy to get that, like within an hour. Somebody will buy what you're looking for, because basically what you're doing is you're putting your Bitcoin into a marketplace, and someone is literally paying 20% over the Bitcoin spot price. And so that, you know, Amazon's getting the full amount they're requesting for the item, but you're getting a 20% discount. I actually put something on for 40% off the other night on saveitpurse.com. Just because I wasn't in a hurry to get, you know, the item. Like, yeah, okay, I'd like to have this, but I don't really need it right now, so I'll set it up at a 40% discount. Figuring it would take several days before somebody actually bought it, it was literally, somebody had snapped it up within an hour at 40%. So you never really know what you're going to get, and it never hurts to try a higher discount for a little bit if you're not in a rush to get something. Go ahead and try it out. Get started at saveitpurse.com. Saveatpurse.com. That's saveatpurse.com. As we continue here, the story from the Washington Post. The piece is written by Janelle Ross, and she is claiming that maybe the people in Oregon should be considered terrorists. Now, I think all three of us here on the show tonight disagree, but let's let her continue to make her case. She says, for those who know the father and son, Dwight Hammond Jr. and his son Stephen Hammond, personally, it's understandable they would disagree vehemently with any government action that implies the men that they know as engaged members of the community are terrorists. But one really cannot help but wonder where similar outrage lives when data clearly indicates that Black Americans are far more likely than white ones to face serious arrest and jail time rather than misdemeanor penalties for resisting arrest. Where has the lockstep adherence to careful and delicate language been in all of 2015 when unarmed Black Americans were disproportionately more likely to be killed by police than others? Beyond that seeming incongruity, the Hammonds are not among the occupiers. The man who has helped to organize the building occupation in Oregon is Ammon Bundy, and Bundy is the son of Cliven Bundy, a Nevada rancher who engaged in a standoff in 2014 with the government over grazing rights. The younger Bundy has again described occupiers as armed and prepared to die. I think it's important to point out here that Cliven Bundy was discouraging people from carrying guns at the protests that happened outside of his ranch, and Cliven Bundy has also spoken out against his son's tactics in this particular case. So just to be clear, not all of the Bundys are of the same mindset here.
Yeah, well, I would imagine that Cliven Bundy is also scared to death, because last time he was involved in the situation, he made a comment about Black people, which, if you really parse it, basically breaks down to the treatment of Black people by the government might be as bad as slavery. But
it came out kind of wrong,
it
right?
It came out sounding terrible. His choice of words was awful. And he's probably scared to death of getting any more spotlight. I would be.
Exactly. I think it's interesting to see how both sides of the mainstream political spectrum tend to be going on this. This is a good moment, and I've written on the original Bundy Ranch incident, I wrote an article about how This incident woke the conservatives up to the problem of police abuse when we saw their own being beaten and tased, etc. And when disseminating that article, it received equal positive results from conservative, libertarian, and liberal audiences. And here we see sort of a, and this, so this is a very good opportunity for us all to collectively sort of come together, and it's some sort of understanding of the over politicization of violence and terrorism, for example. But instead, you're seeing a lot of sort of rising to each other's level of incompetence on this sort of thing, trying to out-shrill each other and trying to sink to equally lower depths.
Your blog post, is that over at thedesertlinks.com, your other site?
Yes, that was over a year ago, I believe, I wrote that one.
The armed occupation, back to the post here, of a federal building might be what Bundy considers an assertion of rights and a mere gathering in a taxpayer-financed space, but it would seem to contain the real risk of violence, serious injury, or even death. Now, and I guess that's because—
Of who? Nobody else is there but the protesters.
Right. It would be of the
protesters.
If they
keep it that way, everybody is perfectly safe. All they have to do to avoid this becoming a dangerous situation is don't bring any federal agents.
But
and you got a bunch of guys
to.
Sitting around in the woods with guns. It's a hunting trip, and they're not catching anything.
You know, I agree with you. That would avoid any violence. There's no doubt about that. And I think eventually they're going to go home. Eventually, like with the Edna Elaine Brown situation here in New Hampshire, which were two tax protesters who the federal government wanted to arrest very much. They had holed up in their house. This was about a decade ago. They had a number of people come out to support them. There was like a big barbecue that the Genesis Communications Network's Ted Anderson, he's the president, and that's our syndicate. They syndicate our show. So Ted came to their house and threw a barbecue, and there was like 100 or more people that attended this thing throughout the day, maybe 200. I don't know. I was actually there for it.
I was there too.
You were
actually
there at the barbecue?
Yeah, yeah. Right. I went out there with this guy from San Francisco named Starchild. Starchild was there.
Wow.
And it was cool. The music there, I actually bought the CD of that band, which was they were very Christian, but some of their songs were wonderful. They did one about how you can take my gun from my cold dead hand that I really enjoyed.
Like Randy Weaver was there.
Yeah,
the guy
Randy
from,
Weaver was there. I met
Ridge.
Him.
So yeah. It was an interesting time, but of course, as with a lot of things, the support petered out over time as well. And so a number of the supporters who were there, actually on the site, living there, you know, you run out of money at some point. You can only dedicate so much time to something, and you know, those people left, and that was when the feds came in ultimately and took Ed and Elaine Brown without a shot fired.
And there's a lesson in that for the activist community, which is if you look at civilly disobedient activists of the past, people like Rosa Parks, you know, they had a community behind them economically that was supporting what they were doing, and that's what made it possible for them to do it. If
right.
there is no economic support going into the liberty community, then yes, sooner or later you have to get home and make something to eat because you'll starve
right.
otherwise. And that's, I mean, that's why I've done so little activism since I first went to jail, is I just have not had the economic means to do it. And I'm finally getting out of that and starting to do some stuff.
Yeah,
but
I think you've been doing some good stuff recently.
If you're going to have frontline activists,
you also have
to have a rear echelon, because without a rear echelon, there is no frontline.
Yeah, it has to be sustainability.
Right.
Sustainability,
and
yes.
And there's people who don't understand that. You know, they look at some of the really visible activism, the Robin Hooding, the 420s, the free Uber, and they say to themselves, well, I can't get arrested. I can't do that. Well, no. Most people don't put themselves out on the front lines like that. You know, there's a very small minority of activists in New Hampshire who are doing that kind of thing. And, you know, only so many people can take those kind of risks. And it does require people to back them up, to be willing to come and, you know, feed the pets when they get, you know, if they get arrested or whatever, to keep the lights, you know, the power turned on at the house, you know, to back them in a lot of different ways. And just moral support, showing up at court and things like that. Toll free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. This is Free Talk Live.
every once in a while you get information that's worth changing your life for. This is one such time. You can save up to and beyond 25% on all purchases at Amazon. You probably heard of Bitcoin and just not thought much about it. You certainly know that you can get competitive pricing at Amazon, but now you can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need to live. I've just given you a huge raise, and all you have to do is claim it. You go to saveitpurse.com and open an account. Do this right now. Don't wait. Then you fund the account with Bitcoin. You can buy them through expresscoin.com with a check or money order. There are other ways to get Bitcoin, but that's fast, safe, and easy. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to saveitpurse.com right now, get signed up, and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 15 to 25% off of everything at Amazon through saveitpurse.com. It's saveatpurse.com.
Did you know that home break-ins increase more than 100% during the holidays? It takes just 10 seconds for an intruder to kick in your door. But police response to a home alarm system is more than 20 minutes. And intruders are in and out of your home in 5 minutes. Thieves know that you're not home and have presents inside just waiting to be taken. And if you are home, how safe will you feel with an intruder lurking inside with your family? That's why police across the country are recommending you use Door Armor. Proven to withstand the force of a battering ram, Door Armor keeps intruders out. It's easy to install and barely visible, and your Door Armor is guaranteed for life. Go to invasionstopper.com for a very special buy one, get one at half off deal. These savings are for a limited time and only available to GCN listeners. Protect your valuables and loved ones this holiday season. Go to invasionstopper.com now. That's invasionstopper.com.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here. And I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com. Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
Cryptocurrency and peer-to-peer tech developments happen fast. Stay in the loop with The Daily Decrypt, a new video channel and podcast that will keep you on top of the latest innovations in crypto finance, security, networking, transportation, and gadgetry like drones and 3D printers. Subscribe to The Daily Decrypt on YouTube and SoundCloud and be an early adopter of the future. The Daily Decrypt.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with a chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us on the radio waves. Toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We have Skype as well. The Skype username is lrn.fm. Feel free to reach out to us that way. And you can bring up whatever is on your mind. A lot of people still talking about the continuing to develop Oregon standoff. I don't know if that's even the right word. I'm not sure the federal government has arrived on the scene. I did hear in a news report today the FBI is, you know, working on negotiating with these folks. I'm not sure exactly what the FBI can negotiate. I mean, these people who are in Oregon occupying allegedly one of the buildings, the Malheur Federal Wildlife Reserve, you know, they want the government to become constitutional again. And, you know, it's not like the FBI's hostage negotiator isn't going to be able to come in there and give them that one, right? I'm not saying they're hostages. I'm just saying they're negotiating. And so that's not going to be on the table. So, you know, how this is
are
all
they what kind of demand? We should write some demands for them. Yeah. Allow Gary Johnson in the debates. Yeah. That would be a start.
Bill of Rights delivered in a briefcase.
So, you're welcome to share your thoughts here, and we're going to go back to your calls here. Let's go to Tom in Nashua. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Tom. Tom in Nashua. Tom going once. Tom.
Yeah, hello, I'm still here.
Hello, Tom, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. You got to turn the volume up. There you go. Now it's about security safes. I was reading up a company that makes these things. Their website says that, you know, these cheap safes coming from big box stores and imported from China, they specify, you know, like what the specs are, the wall width and stuff like that. But what it is a sheet of steel and then a bunch of household drywall and then another sheet metal steel. And they quote the whole thing as wall thickness. So they don't bother to mention that a lot of that wall thickness is household drywall, which is good for fire insulation, but that's about it. And so, you know, it's one of these things where, you know, you got a lot of people with firearms and precious metals that are interested in safes. And
sure.
They really need to learn about that. And there's videos.
So you're saying buyer beware. Safes are not necessarily as they are purporting themselves to be. You need to be careful when you're looking at the specs and know exactly what questions to ask and what to look for. I think it's good advice.
And careful to install it properly, because if a thing just absolutely could not be moved, you'd never be able to get it to your house. So
anything
can be moved.
I remember moving the Circuit City safe years ago. Our old co-host Sam Dodson, Circuit City closed down obviously all across the United States, and they had a store here in Keene, and they're selling everything. So they sold their safe, and it was this massive, huge safe that was so heavy. I mean, a huge group of men were very just barely able to move that thing. Man, it can be a nightmare. I think that was one of the good ones. Hey, Tom, thanks for your call tonight. Toll-free number 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. So is it terrorism or is it treason? Joel, you had heard people referring to the situation out in Oregon as treason. Is that right?
Yes, exactly. I don't understand. And that seems to be a term that's bandied about a lot more common among conservative circles than liberal circles. But in this case, it was a liberal who was actually bandying about this term. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because
I think you hear it more out of conservatives these days just because there's a liberal in office. I remember hearing the word treason applied to George Bush when he was in office by liberals. It's just, you know, Obama could do anything and the liberals couldn't completely denounce him.
Yes, and it seems that treason, betraying your government, it sounds like it makes a lot more sense if you're talking about someone employed by said government who then turns coat against and joins with another force.
Mm-hmm.
But for a citizen to protest against government, calling that treason, especially in a country that's supposed to have, you know,
free speech,
supposed to, according to, you know, founding principles, in theory, supposed to be a government by the people, of the people, and for the people, i.e. to serve the people. So how can the people betray the thing that's supposed to serve them? It's a weird sort of circular reasoning.
What they're doing is technically sedition. It's not treason. And there was an Alien and Sedition Act passed very early in American history that criminalized speaking against some war or another. But it was pretty quickly found unconstitutional, I believe.
If you want to join us here, the toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. A little bit more here from the Washington Post. Their piece here is asking, are they terrorists? Deliberate language choices are always a wise and reasonable move, says the author. That is especially true when telling stories of conflict with government and political protest. But the incredibly limited and relatively soft range of words in wide use Sunday seems to extend beyond all of that. And I don't know if I agree. I mean, I don't think it would be inaccurate to call this terrorism because no violence has been used. But to call them a militia, I think absolutely is kind of, you know, rattling the saber a little bit. I mean, that's...
Have you noticed that they always quotate the word militia?
No, they don't always.
I guess not always. The left-wing media quotates it and the right-wing media doesn't.
It's actually
one of the quickest ways to figure out the bias of your author is look at whether or not they quotate militia.
Exactly. It's also, it's interesting how the whole war of words tends to be much more emotionally based. And because these are, as it turns out, actual terms that have actual definitions. And those definitions, for example, treason, terrorism, militia, etc., seem to be sort of lost in translation.
Mm-hmm.
She says, going on here, the description of events in Oregon appear to reflect the usual shape of our collective assumptions about the relationship between race and guilt or religion and violent extremism in the United States. She claims that white Americans, their activities and ideas seem always to stem from a font of principled and committed individuals. As such, group suspicion and presumed guilt are readily perceived and described as just, unreasonable, and unethical. She goes on to say that you will note that while the group gathered in Oregon is almost assuredly all or nearly all white, that has scarcely been mentioned in any story. You will note that nothing even close to similar can be said about coverage of events in Missouri, Maryland, Illinois, or any other place where questions about policing have given way to protests or actual riots.
Yeah, that's probably a fair observation. However, I don't think the solution to that is to pinpoint the race of other groups more often.
It
should be to roll it back and just sort of tell it like it is. And unless, of course, you're talking about, for example, a white nationalist or white supremacist group that self-identifies, that's a big part of their identity and their mission in this action, then it might be fair to mention their ethnicity, but just random other group.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the funny thing is that that's actually, I don't know why this is on my mind tonight, but that's another way that I'll snoop out bias in an article is look at, you know, do they describe the races of the people involved and which races are it? Because things that come from, if something describes a bunch of violent people, if it says in the headline that they were black, then it's a right-wing publication. And if it says they were white, mm-hmm. it's a left-wing publication. If it doesn't say, then it's one of the, it could be either way talking about the opposite group. It's really strange to watch. As somebody who actually isn't racist, it's really bizarre to watch the way, you know, they both play. Both sides are race baiting.
Playing the race card. Sure.
Both sides are race baiting, and both sides are constantly accusing the other side of race baiting, but they're both doing it.
And if that's what sells newspapers or whatever gets people to tune in to the next news segment after the commercial break, then, you know, I guess you could argue they're just playing to their audience, too.
That's definitely true. I mean, the bigger your audience is, the more likely it is that any given person will see your articles. So yeah, we mostly see the people who play to their audiences because they're the ones who get big.
So we're going to continue here, and we'll talk about Rights Brigade, I think, coming up in hour number three. Joel Valenzuela, the founder of Rights Brigade, which has really taken off in a way that I'm really happy to see, and I think Rich Paul is as well, as we've both been involved with the jury outreach activism here for a long time in New Hampshire, and it's really nice to see it expanding in the way that it has done, which is largely because of your doing. I mean, essentially, you picked up the ball in, I think, seven counties in New Hampshire or something like that.
Exactly.
And you found volunteers who were willing to help out because you can't do it all yourself. And we'll talk about that here and how you managed to sort of finagle all that. Maybe some of our listeners can learn a thing or two from, you know, how to facilitate activism and to help other people be better activists. 855-450-FREE is our toll-free number if you want to join us here. 855-450-3733. How to be an effective libertarian activist. We'll continue. And this is Free Talk Live.
Are your kids spending too much time online? Are they gaming instead of doing homework? Are they on Facebook instead of sleeping? Turn their internet access on or off when you want for free at webcurfew.com. 100% web-based interface means nothing to download, install, or configure. Webcurfew is free and controls any device using your home network without slowing down your internet. Block all adult web content with a click of a button. Don't let the internet raise your kids. Take back control of how and when your home internet is used for free. Visit webcurfew.com.
As a pioneer of the e-commerce movement, Overstock.com is proud to be the first major retailer to accept Bitcoin. Overstock was the first because Patrick Byrne, Overstock's CEO and founder, firmly believes in personal freedom and cryptocurrency. Over the past 16 years, Overstock has furnished over 18 million homes with a diverse line of products to suit everyone's unique styles and preferences. Support Overstock and freedom of choice while enjoying free shipping on orders of 0.211 Bitcoin or more. The new fourth edition of Healing Our World, The Compassion of Libertarianism, will take your understanding of liberty to a deeper level and has over 1,300 updated references, new cartoons, and a foreword by Dr. Ron Paul. With discounts for multiple book purchases, the fourth edition of Healing Our World is a great gift for the liberals, pragmatists, environmentalists, and Christians in your life who think libertarianism is cold-hearted. Get yours today at healing.freetalklive.com and use promo code FTL for a $5 discount.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, January 4th, 2016. Silver is trading at $13.89 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,064 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $432. Antiwar.com reports after 9 days of more or less constant airstrikes against targets inside Yemen, Saudi Arabia announced on Sunday that they are abandoning their ceasefire in Yemen and that it is because the Shiite Houthis are violating the terms. The ceasefire was initially meant to facilitate peace talks, though fighting never really slowed down, and indeed, Saudi-backed forces occupied several cities over the course of the 9-day period. The peace talks ended without any real progress. It is unclear what, if any, differences there will be in the Yemen war without the ceasefire, though it will likely mean the Saudis won't feel the need to publicly blame the Houthis every time they unilaterally launch an airstrike on a city. In talking up the Houthi violations, the Saudis cited missiles fired from Yemen into Saudi territory. Such strikes have happened off and on throughout the war, killing a handful of people.
For nearly 40 years, Roberts & Roberts Brokerage has been a trusted source for buying and selling precious metals like gold and silver. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and have permanently removed the minimum purchase amount for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on buying and selling precious metals and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 800-874-9760 or visit online at rrbi.co.
UPI reports an armed group has seized control of a federal building in Oregon to protest alleged unconstitutional action by the U.S. government after holding a rally showing support for ranchers convicted of arson. The incident began in the town of Burns, Oregon, where protesters were voicing support for Dwight Hammond and his son Stephen, who were convicted of arson in 2012 and served time in prison, but whose sentences a court later ruled were too short. The men were scheduled to turn themselves in on Monday to serve 5 years in prison. prison. Dwight Hammond said he and his son are planning to peacefully report to prison despite the protest. After the rally on Saturday, the protesters broke into the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge's unoccupied government building less than 30 miles away and refused to leave. The group said it could possibly stay in the compound for years and may use violence if authorities attempt to evict them. Ammon Bundy, a spokesman for the group, told CNN, "We will be here as long as it takes. We have no intentions of using force upon anyone, but if force is used against us, we would defend ourselves." Some in the local community disagree with the group's steps, calling them a militia. Ammon Bundy is the son of Cliven Bundy, a Nevada rancher who gained international attention in 2014 after staging an armed standoff with federal authorities over a grazing dispute with the Bureau of Land Management. Ammon Bundy said they will be bringing the lands up and getting the ranchers back to ranching, the miners back to mining, putting the loggers back to logging, where they can do it under the protection of the people and not be afraid of this tyranny that has been upon them. In the arson case, the Hammonds said they lit the fires to reduce the growth of invasive species and protect their lands from wildfires.
Are you an advocate for free market money? Do you promote Bitcoin as an alternative in a fiat-centric world? Then you need Spendabit in your arsenal, the search engine for things you can buy with Bitcoin. Spendabit aggregates millions of products from thousands of Bitcoin-enabled merchants. Keep your money in the free economy. Visit spendabit.co today. Bitcoin merchants, ask about our merchant suite to reach even more customers. Spendabit.co.
Reuters reports New York Governor Andrew Cuomo signed an executive order on Sunday requiring local officials throughout the state to force the homeless into shelters when temperatures dip below freezing and vowed to defend the edict if challenged in court. The order, which takes effect on Tuesday, requires social service agencies and police to move homeless individuals into shelters against their will if necessary when the temperature is at or below 32 degrees Fahrenheit, 0 degrees Celsius. The order also requires shelters to extend hours of operation to ensure that homeless people can stay inside whenever there is inclement winter weather, which can cause hypothermia, serious injury, and death. According to the order, state law allows for the involuntary placement of homeless individuals so they do not cause harm to themselves or others. Officials at the Coalition for the Homeless Advocacy Group in New York City could not be reached for comment. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
A new report released this week has found that nearly three-quarters of sleepaway campers' parents are currently using their children's time away from home to take the first steps towards filing for divorce.
With 46% of campers' moms currently staying with their sisters while they try to figure it out, and 38% of campers' dads sleeping on the living room couch and staring at the ceiling for hours before falling asleep.
Most campers are, at this precise moment, wholly unaware that their fathers are looking for temporary sublets and are experiencing a level of carefree, joyful buoyancy that experts say they will never feel again.
The majority of campers currently have, on average, 16 days until their lives come crashing down around them, at which point their parents will pick them up from camp, drive them to a restaurant, and then break the news that while they'll always be a family, they won't be living together anymore.
I love camp this year. It's so much fun. Mom sent me so many care packages. Dad even sent one. It's awesome.
This is the Onion News Network.
You can join us here on Free Talk Live. You can bring up whatever's on your mind. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We've got Ian and Rich in the studio here tonight. Rich is back from vacation.
Yay!
And Joel Valenzuela is joining us here as our guest co-host. It's been great, by the way, having you here so far.
No, thank you.
And your website, you got a couple of them. TheDesertLinks.com is like your personal blog. And then rightsbrigade.com is sort of a bigger concept where you had said earlier in the show tonight that you were inspired by the lack of coverage of activism that was happening in other areas of New Hampshire. And I'm glad that you started rightsbrigade.com. There's also another site, Shire Liberty News, that started a couple, like a year or two ago, probably like 2 years ago. And they're doing some level of covering things, and I'm grateful for that too.
I think they stopped.
Oh no!
Was that Sandy?
Yes, I heard. It might have been just the newsletter. I really don't want to step on anyone's toes by incorrectly reporting.
Well, they weren't. They're not as like heavy on their posts as Freekeen, instance, because I think it's pretty much just Sandy. I don't know if she has any other folks helping her out there, but looks like looks like September was maybe the last time some posts were made.
That checks out.
But anyway, rightsbrigade.com is your site. You are putting fresh content up, and you've been focusing mostly on jury outreach. It seems that's been like I think your 2015 real big project.
Exactly. Like. Of the 79. Instances of activism in 2015, 57 of them were jury related.
79 instances of activism that you were involved with?
Yes, or? that I was directly involved with.
Wow, you've been keeping track. That's impressive.
Yeah. Well, of course, that was the other thing about it is I wanted to have it perfectly cataloged so you could see how many times this happens. And I was able to, by reporting, for example, like counting the number of jury flyers before and after each selection, able to estimate. And the numbers are pretty good. So, 7 courthouses, right, in New Hampshire.
Only 10 counties. And
yeah,
so
11 courthouses.
Right, there's one county with 2, right?
Exactly, Hillsborough. So, we've hit 7 of them. So that's more than half. We've repeatedly hit.
And that doesn't include Keene, right? Or are you including Keene?
I don't think I'm including Keene in that number.
So, make it 8.
Yeah, we've been able to do pretty well. And usually the first... across the jury selection, there's several selections. The first one, usually you get the big crowd, and then there's less as the selections go on. It's an average for each pool of, I guess, 150 people, right?
Really? And now we're in this is in the other in all of the towns? Because here in New Hampshire, the most recent one was like 60.
Yes, from my estimations. For example, today in Concord, I managed to reach, 53.
Okay.
53, and then... But the Monies out in Brentwood, in Rockingham County, which includes Portsmouth, got over 170 today.
Wow. Okay.
So that's over 225 jurors reached just in 2016.
It may depend on the number of cases they're selecting for, perhaps. You know, like
exactly.
Perhaps Rockingham County has more jury trials than Concord does.
Yes. As it turns out, the coast is the most heavily, the most population-dense general area of the whole state.
Really?
Yes.
More so than Manchester.
Manchester is a metropolitan area, right? Mm-hmm. But the entire coastal region, everything east of Manchester tends to have a higher population density than anywhere else in the state.
I didn't know that.
And so between Stratford County and Dover, right, and Rockham County and Brentwood, you get some pretty heavy saturation. So averaged out, right, about 150 not per selection, but per jury pool, which is usually 2-3 selections, or possibly 4. It's estimated we reached over 3,000 jurors in 2015.
Wow, that's huge. Congratulations
just,
on that.
And it hasn't been, I mean, I've been consistently doing it, and there's been a couple others who've been consistently doing it, but this hasn't been like an army we've had doing this. It's just been a few people.
It's a core group of people who are dedicated. But that's all it takes. I mean, to do consistent activism is to have that core group of people who are willing to show up on a monthly basis or every 2 weeks. I know there's some places it's more frequent than others. To get out there and to just consistently do something and have that impact over time. Here in the Keene area, of course, we've been doing this jury outreach for years. And Grafton, I think, had done it for a while. I don't know what their current status is.
Exactly.
Was that one of the counties that you were not
doing? No, I did not manage to reach Grafton.
So I don't know. Like, Grafton's like a black hole for activists. I mean, there's activists there, but, you know, you never know what they're doing. And it's that problem that you were talking about before where there could be someone reporting on what's going on in Grafton, but there's not. And because there's not, we don't know what goes on there, except every now and then we might hear a rumor or something like that.
Yeah.
But just for our listeners that don't know, when we're talking about jury outreach, we're talking about jury nullification, which is the idea of a juror, your right to, you have the right as a juror to vote your conscience in a case. You can vote how you feel about the law, not just whether or not it was violated. So the state will tell you that you have to judge based on the facts in the case and determine whether the law was violated. You can actually vote not guilty if you're on a jury, if you think the law is bad. So, Rich, you went to a jury trial for selling cannabis, and had I been on that jury, which they would never let me on it, but had I been on it, I could have used jury nullification and voted not guilty, even though they had video footage of you selling cannabis and, you know, and a snitch testifying that you sold it to him. So, like, the facts in the case were clear. You sold the cannabis. You even admitted
Oh, yeah, I sold it.
Right. Mm. But you know, you can use jury nullification to set someone free. And we have seen it happen a couple of times, which is always very exciting when it does. In fact, our friend James Cleveland was just recently nullified on his you can argue he was nullified on both counts. But he was facing resisting arrest and disorderly conduct charges for recording the police here in Keene, and the jury returned a not guilty verdict on the resisting charge, and further, they were hung on the disorderly charge. So it wasn't a perfect nullification, but I think you could argue that it might have been.
Yeah, and if you ever find yourself on a jury and you're the only one arguing for nullification, do know that a hung jury is significantly better for the defendant than a conviction.
Oh, yeah.
So don't go with the sheep, please. Stand your ground.
So part of this outreach is to encourage people to, you know, use their rights to stand up for the freedoms of other people.
Yes, and as it turns out, this right is specifically protected under New Hampshire law.
It is now, although the Supreme Court kind of rejected that in Rich Paul's case because he appealed to the Supreme Court here, and they basically verbally eviscerated the statute in question, which sort of upholds jury nullification.
I don't know that I quite take that that dim a view of what the Supreme Court did. The original law said, when it was first introduced, that that the judge had to instruct the jury on jury nullification, and that was taken out of the bill.
Sadly,
and it was a toned down bill. So that's, to me, where the defense had the right to tell the jury about jury nullification, and that's a huge difference. It's still a benefit because it opens up the possibility of bringing in experts on drug abuse to argue against the marijuana laws. That's something you couldn't do in any other state, but because we explicitly acknowledge nullification here, it's possible that when the prosecutor says objection irrelevant, the defense will be able to say it goes to nullification and get their question and their witness in.
I think that's true.
So that's huge.
But I just, I wanted to point out, though, because somebody could call us out and say, yeah, but the Supreme Court said this and that. It's still on the books. They didn't, get rid of the law. It's still there, this statute that sort of enshrines the idea of nullification. The problem with the statute is it doesn't use the word nullification. And so the Supreme Court did rule that, this isn't a nullification statute, is what they said in your case, ultimately. And anybody who wants to read the actual decision can. We posted it at freekeen.com. But that's going to be improved over time. There's, I think, another bill that's been proposed for this coming session that's going to better enshrine jury nullification, to mandate that judges have to give jury nullification instructions to juries. So this is a foot in the door of jury nullification, and it has already resulted in judges sitting back and saying nothing when nullification is being discussed in their courtroom. The most recent episode was, of course, James Cleveland's trial. And there's footage of this, of his attorney giving a 3-minute nullification pitch to this jury, and the judge just sits there and lets it happen. There's no objection from the prosecution. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE.
Message for anyone with sleep apnea who is on the go and tired of dragging around a big, bulky home CPAP device. MiniCPAP.com now offers a portable device that's as small as a soda can and weighs less than a pound. For even more freedom, you can add a battery that's as tiny as a deck of cards. It's called the Transcend Mini CPAP, and right now you can try it risk-free for 21 days by calling 1-800-939-8536. Transcend is the world's first portable mini CPAP device. It gives you the freedom to sleep in total comfort anywhere you are. Our smallest and most advanced portable design ever, Transcend, is so small and so light you can fit it in your briefcase or purse to use anywhere you go. It's FAA compliant too, so you can even sleep comfortably while flying. Enjoy the freedom to sleep comfortably anywhere. Call MiniCPAP.com now for your 21-day in-home trial. 1-800-939-8536. That's 1-800-939-8536.
Are you worried about your mom or dad living alone in their house? Hi, I'm Joan London.
Listen, I know how difficult it is to find senior care for someone you love. That's why I recommend a free service called A Place for Mom. They are the nation's largest senior living referral service. Call A Place for Mom today.
To receive free information on senior living communities in your area, call A Place for Mom at 1-800-704-6182.
A Place for Mom offers free one-on-one advice from local advisors and a personalized list of senior living communities you can visit. If you have questions about senior care for your mom or dad, there's a place for answers, A Place for Mom.
Call A Place for Mom in the next 10 minutes to get your free ebook on financing senior care as well as free information on senior living communities in your area. Call 1-800-704-6182. That's 1-800-704-6182.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. Physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com. You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
Currency is too important a thing to be left in the hands of government bureaucrats, especially when billions of dollars can be created with the swipe of a pen. Overstock.com supports the cryptocurrency movement because it returns the power of an inflation-proof money to the people where it belongs. Did you know that you can use Bitcoin to pay for anything Overstock.com sells while enjoying free shipping on orders of 0.211 Bitcoin or more? If you support freedom in the cryptocurrency movement, you should support Overstock.com.
Help get LRN.FM into more ears. Visit promote.lrn.fm for a free bumper sticker, flyers, banners, graphics, and more. Promote.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live, and you can join us toll-free here, 855-450-FREE. We're talking about the unmatched jury nullification outreach that happens here in New Hampshire. There's nowhere else in the country where this happens to the level that it happens here. And Joel Valenzuela is with us. It's Ian and Rich Paul in the studio. And you really took it to a new level. I mean, there have been a couple of areas of New Hampshire where this jury outreach had been happening on a pretty consistent basis. Keene has been really consistent over the years. Grafton has done it off and on. But you took it up to seven more counties, seven more courthouses. And over the last year, you estimated 3,000 people were given a jury nullification, jury outreach.
That's
flyer.
Correct.
It's an incredible success story. And I think, you know, obviously we can only go up from here and cover all 11 courthouses eventually. Once we get more people moving here as part of the Free State Project, yeah. If you've yet to join, you know, I haven't checked the numbers today. It had been going up by like 1%. We were at 92% last time I looked.
I believe the projection is either tomorrow or Wednesday to hit 93%.
Looks like I mean, that sounds
we
right.
We should start doing a daily countdown on Free Keen or something.
Followed
something.
By a kiss at midnight.
I have been posting when they will increase to one by 1%, although I haven't posted the most recent 1% because it came so fast. It was 30 days from 89 to 90%. It was then 9 days from 90 to 91%, then 4 days from 91 to 92%. And now here we are. I think we're at about 3 days into the 92%, and we're within striking distance, about 69 signatures away from 93%. sense. So I think you're right. Tomorrow or Wednesday, we're going to cross that threshold.
Yes. It's going now, to be after triggered 20, before you know it.
After 20,000, I believe there will be no more signers. The organization is done.
I don't know about that.
Well, if you want to be part of the first 20,000 signers, then let me say, strike while the iron is hot, because momentum is picking up here. And
we're going to be done by Liberty Forum, don't you think?
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
And my prediction is that the late movers or the late signers in a lot of cases will move sooner than a lot of the earlier signers.
I think you're right about that. A lot of the earlier ones may not even know. They might have changed their email address. So we're not going to get all 20,000. I mean, let's be realistic.
Yeah, and from insider information.
Oh, we'll get 20,000 movers, but not all of them will be signers.
Correct.
It could be. Yeah, I do know that there are some people working for the project who are going back to those old ones, making sure they have updated contact information, et cetera, and like hunting down the old ones.
Okay, that's good
to
know.
So it's being kept up to date.
I can tell you that I don't know how up to date you can keep it beyond a certain point, because a decade ago when for people that know the Free State Project, the idea of moving libertarians, voluntarists, people who love liberty to New Hampshire and getting active to achieve liberty in our lifetime, 20,000 was the goal. At 5,000 members, the Free State Project had 10 candidate states, and they conducted a vote. New Hampshire won overwhelmingly in that vote, and then after that, the sign-up rate slowed down dramatically. So it's been pretty hard to get to that 20,000 number. But when I was living in Florida, I wanted to start Free State Project local groups. I don't know how many of them they still have, but they did have them back then, and the idea was, you know, get together with your future neighbors now. So let's gather the Free Staters, the people who are signed up that live in the area in Southwest Florida where I lived, and, you know, just get together for meetings and talk and get to know one another, that kind of thing. So in order to create that local group, I reached out to the Free State Project. They provided me with the database of all of the signers in my county and all the adjacent counties. So I had dozens and dozens of names that I went through one by one. And this was a decade ago. And significant number of them were I couldn't reach them. There was, you know, the email address was bad, phone number was bad, couldn't even send the mail at the you know, the address that they lived at. So I, you know, I do question whether we're even going to get to 10,000 out of the 20,000 originals. But I like where you're coming from, Rich, in that, you know, it's going to be inevitable that more libertarians are going to come to New Hampshire with or without the Free State Project because of the successes.
We've already reached sufficient critical mass to make movements in the right directions, and that's with 2,000 people.
Barely 2,000.
Barely 2,000. If it might be 1,800, I don't know. But it's
and come on, let's be realistic. The 80-20 rule is still in effect. Of 2,000, you're really only talking about a few hundred people who are the real key doers and the people who are out there doing a lot of activism.
Yes, also it's not necessarily just what kind of people would be down to do that, but what kind of people are. For example, a couple of my best Rights Brigade activists were effectively doing no activism before they got involved, and now that they're some of the most consistent and fearless
now
in the entire state.
That's a good point.
Energizing the people that are already there. But I think...
And that's happening with the natives, too, which is important to point out, too. So the numbers we're talking about are only of the Free State Project signers. We also have 2,000 people who are like New Hampshire natives and long-timers that have been here who have also signed up as friends of the Free State Project. And many of those are also very active. And I think Uber Grandma is a great example of sort of activating a New Hampshire native who has been here for a long time. She wasn't intending to be an activist. She just wanted to drive for Uber. But when the state cracked down on her, she had all this support coming from the liberty community here. Without that support, she likely would have folded and called it a day. I suspect that it was because of the support of the Free Staters and the liberty community was what turned her into an activist. And now she's like, you know, making headlines and is doing interviews.
As it turns out, when you stand up for the rights of others, especially if you have nothing to gain from that, they will really respond.
Yeah, exactly. So the, you know, the thousands of Free Staters that are coming here are just going to help seed the New Hampshire natives and the people who also love freedom who moved here for decades to get them active, to get them excited about the potential to actually have more freedom in our lifetime. That's happening.
Exactly. And Jason Sorens, the fellow who wrote the original paper of the Free State Project,
he's the founder.
Yeah, the founder he estimates of the 20,000, his personal estimate is about 8,000 of them
is what he's expecting to show up.
Yes, eight of the 20,000,
And that would be awesome.
Yeah, that's probably pretty accurate. I agree with Rich on the we will get 20,000. It won't necessarily be the 20,000 that signed up. But once you have, I mean, once you have a place where, to be honest, libertarianism has not been a very successful ideology in terms of gaining ground historically, as in gaining political power, gaining...
Until now.
Yes, until now.
We're starting to learn how to game the system in New Hampshire.
And so now that when you have, this could be the first libertarian success story on planet Earth right here. And once you
already is, in my opinion. Yes, I mean, look, you've got libertarians getting elected as Republicans and Democrats here.
I think
we've got like 12 anarchists in the state house. Yes. That just, every time I think that, I'm like, I get down and I'm just like, yeah, well, doesn't matter what they do to me, doesn't matter what they say to me. We've got 12 anarchists in the state house.
And now, it's interesting because I've noticed this in the years that I've been here, when I've been trying... The month after I moved here, I started attending conferences to try to get more signers, more people to come here. And the response has changed over the years. It was always pretty positive, but before, less people knew about the Free State Project, and more people were like, yeah, okay, that's cool.
Yeah,
but
I heard
in North Carolina they're doing something, or I heard in Texas.
Yeah, and there's all these wannabe copycats.
Yes, each passing year, they mention it less and less fervently. Mm-hmm. Now I think obviously this is the first real libertarian success story already, but it's becoming more and more undeniable.
I think you're right about that. And that's what's going to bring the full 20,000 over time. Is, you know, if you're a libertarian and you are hearing about what's happening here, you're going to want to be here. 855-450-FREE is our toll-free number, 855-450-3733. Effective liberty activism. Will continue the discussion.
Removing bad taste and odor from your drinking water is easy. Removing the bad stuff you don't taste is what ProPure does best. Water the way nature meant it to be. Clean, crisp, and refreshing. See the complete line of ProPure countertop, inline gravity, and household water filtration products. Visit your authorized ProPure dealer or ProPureUSA.com. That's ProPureUSA.com. Or call 800-544-3533.
So you've got to take a state construction license exam or certification. Can't decide on what books or what chapters to study? Discover right now how you can eliminate unnecessary books and wasted study time. At contractorexam.com, our study materials zero in on state-required test topics in an effective, multiple-choice format. So whether you're a plumber, electrician, general contractor, or other construction-related trade, contractorexam.com will help get you prepared. Visit us at www.contractorexam.com today.
The easiest thing in the world for a reader to do is to stop reading. According to the late, great Barney Kilgore, who became managing editor of the Wall Street Journal in 1941 and grew the paper's circulation from 33,000 to 1 million by the 60s. And he'd be pleased to know that his paper is one of the few that people now pay to read online. Someone else pre-internet who realized that attention is fragile? Motown Records founder Berry Gordy. In the early 60s, when his label dominated the charts, he'd bring a dozen real people into the Hitsville, USA studios and audition songs. And he'd ask, if you were down to your last dollar, would you spend it on this record or would you buy a sandwich? Today, attention span seems like an oxymoron. For tips on cutting through the clutter, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
You can control your health care with Liberty HealthShare.
Liberty HealthShare is like-minded people coming together to share medical costs, which saves money.
You don't even have to pay for procedures that violate your conscience.
Because we all share the same values.
Join the movement of people who share in medical costs and change the way you pay for your health care forever.
Go to libertyhealthshare.org to find out more.
Liberty HealthShare.
Together, we're changing health care for good. libertyhealthshare.org.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
Free Talk Live.
When a deer approaches a marijuana plant in the woods and nibbles off one of the buds, is that sad? Is that deer living a sad state of existence?
I have no idea. I've never heard of an animal eating something
but
that would
Christy,
make them,
that's because you
know,
have no idea what you're talking about. You don't know one thing about cannabis. You don't know anything about it.
I understand that you want to partake of that drug.
Oh,
and
I do. Trust
but
me.
Listen, I understand that you should have the right to do that.
Well, thank you.
Where it's legal. Where it's
legal. Since the beginning of time, human beings and other animals have been altering their state of consciousness. Believe it or not, it's not just a human being thing.
Robins eat elderberries in the fall and get drunk on them.
Yes, so this is a common thing amongst the various different creatures of this earth.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM. This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at LRN.FM.
It's Free Talk Live, and you can join us toll-free here, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Also, you can join us over on Skype at Skype username LRN.FM, and... Ian and Rich Paul in the studio. Rich, you are one of the ministers of the Church of the Invisible Hand. Can you tell the audience a little bit about that?
Yeah, I started up the Church of the Invisible Hand when I was in jail. It's basically an encapsulation of a lot of the things that brought me to the philosophical and spiritual point that I'm at now. It our estimated prophets include Murray Rothbard and Ayn Rand and Milton Friedman, as well as Galileo scientists. And we basically believe that although there may have been a God that created the universe, that God doesn't intervene in it. So the best thing to do is to learn and obey the laws of nature, because nature, to be commanded, must be obeyed. And we believe that, you know, if we just learn to tolerate each other and find out how the universe works, that we can make a peaceful and prosperous world.
Invisiblehand.church is the website.
Invisiblehand.church. And also, if you enjoy my work on Free Talk Live, I've got a Patreon account.
Is that linked to from Invisiblehand.church?
If not, it should be. It's probably on my fundraising page.
I'm not sure.
Well, you can also catch my fundraising page at richpaul.com. Freekeen.com.
Great way to get behind Rich's efforts and his activism. And as you were talking about before, you know, those on the front lines appreciate support from people who all you can do is kick in $5 a month. Well, gosh, I sure do appreciate it.
Oh, that's great, because that adds up.
Yeah, it sure does.
The Patreon.com thing is we ask people to pledge $1 a show. And even that, you know, if you do a show once a week, I mean, if you get a lot of people doing it, it's a wonderful thing. And, you know, that allows me to finance the other activism that I do, which is not easy to monetize.
So Joel Valenzuela is with us from rightsbrigade.com, has done a lot of jury outreach and has covered it over at rightsbrigade.com. So that's, I think, an amazing project, and it's great to see it. And hopefully it'll expand even further as more people come here. But there was an interesting point you made, and that was that there were some people who had moved here as part of the Free State Project and hadn't really gotten their feet wet in the activism scene. And then they got into this jury rights outreach and they've really taken the ball and run with it. And I think that's what we've seen happen over time here. I mean, I've been here for almost an entire decade at this point. And a lot of the people who moved to New Hampshire as part of the Free State Project, which for those just tuning in is a migration of libertarians coming to New Hampshire. You can go to freestateproject.org to learn more about it. But a lot of them have never done a shred of activism in their lives. Have you come across this before?
Yes, most people. And not everyone is crazy social butterfly like I was. Not everyone goes out looking, where the activism at? Where the activism
at? Right.
And so that was the main driving sort of philosophy behind doing the Rights Brigade, is I want it to be a one-stop shop for activism. Not trying to edge people out or do things other people are doing. For example, with the jury activism, I'm partnering with NH Jury, mm-hmm. who provides all the flyers. And then I've assisted out in free Uber. I've also done a lot of, we've done a lot of state house activism, legislative stuff, partnered with the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance.
Yep.
And so also done some.
All of these are Free State involved activism.
Some independence activism, partnering with the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence. And so rather than each organization trying to fight for their media spotlight to get people to go be involved, I want to provide a centralized area where people can say, I want to get involved, and then they go, and here's the menu of available options.
They can plug in
and they
something.
Just go, because a lot of people, very willing activists, that just don't know how to get involved. And
that's one thing. Plus, people aren't generally leaders, so they do, you know, it's good for someone who's in a leadership role, mm-hmm. as you are, to create this sort of system for them to plug into. And a basic example of this, sort of the classic example, is if you want to do a protest, then you provide the signs for people to show up and hold. You can't expect someone to show up with their own creative signs that they've taken time, because it takes time to make these things. You can hope that they'll show up, but you can't expect they'll show up with any kind of signage. So you provide the signage, then let them pick the ones they like and go out and hold those signs. Now, that means that you can still have a core group of doers who will make the signs on another occasion, and then have a larger group of people who can just kind of plug in to that protest. And that's what people need to really find out what they like, because sometimes people will move here and I'll ask them, I'll say, well, you know, what's the kind of activism that's exciting to you? And they don't really know, because they've never really done anything. And so there's a lot of people. I don't know what the breakdown is as far as people who've moved here who've done activism, where they're from. I did when I was in Florida. What about you, Rich? Well, you were like a computer programmer, right? Did you ever do
anything? I was a computer programmer. I sent a lot of checks. I sent checks to the Libertarian Party. I sent checks to the Ron Paul campaign.
But did you ever go hold a sign somewhere?
I didn't go and hold signs. If I had, I would have been alone in Tampa. I actually suggested it. I used to be involved with the Libertarian Party in Tampa.
Yep.
And
sit around at a meeting every week and bitch about the government kind of
thing. Yeah, which was nice, because it was the only time I came into contact with actual other libertarians.
Many were there, by the way, attending Tampa, which is a market of like almost 2 million people, I think. How many were attending the Libertarian Party meetings?
Well, I was going in its heyday when the owner of the Mons Venus Strip Club was running for city council.
I remember that guy, Joe Redfern.
Redmond. Yeah, we should contact him, man. We need a good strip club in New Hampshire. He doesn't have to move up himself. But
how many were going to the meetings?
But I think we were getting 8 to 10.
Yeah.
These were the glory days of
like
Tampa
I said,
libertarianism.
We've got that many people on this street corner right here who are libertarians. Now, Joel, you came up from Arizona. Was
exactly.
it Phoenix? What area?
Phoenix.
And
yep.
what
4 million people metropolitan area, pretty big.
What was your experience with the liberty movement over there?
Well, to backtrack just a little bit, all my young teen to late teen to early professional career, I was involved with nonprofit think tanks and other political activist type groups. Mm-hmm. And so
around
the world, I used to work in DC, in the DC area.
Right.
And there's quite a few libertarians professionally employed in DC because that's sort of
talking about tilting at windmills.
Exactly. They're sort of attacking the beast at its heart, right? They're hacking at the many branches instead of striking the root. So when I moved to Arizona, here and there, I mean, I worked with Americans for Prosperity before, which is in Arizona, was at the time a one-man operation.
Mm-hmm.
I helped organize the first tea parties in Arizona back when it was about taxed enough already and before it became just sort of a cultural jumping point for all kinds of dissatisfaction with the left. Mm-hmm. And then I co-hosted the Valley, being the Phoenix Valley, right? The Valley Austrian Economics Meetup. And it was about a half dozen or so libertarians mm-hmm. from like the hardcore anarcho-capitalist type, usually libertarians from the area. And that was sort of my one big, the one consistent group was at like 4 to 7 people that would show up. And I did go to the Students for Liberty meetups at the local universities, mm-hmm. but even then,
how many
like,
there?
When you got to, it was about a core 3 to half dozen, leaders, right? People, organizers, and then they'd bring just random interested students into like a classroom, And that would be like a dozen or so, a little bit more.
And of
more.
Course, many of the students would never come back, right? Like,
yeah.
It come once and then...
Yeah, it would be like an average, like 50, like 12 to 20, which is a fun little group. But still, and then I'd try to get people to go out and do things and...
Oh, that's tough.
Not really. I mean, it's especially tough for me because I didn't exactly know what to do. There's no... I just show up at the activism store and buy into some activism. It's not that simple. And so that's one thing that... Coming here was a lot more simple because there's a lot more like-minded people,
a lot more people willing to do something.
Yes, but at the same time, no, as I called it before, activism store, right? No one-stop shop to sort of go and, okay, what can I do?
Toll-free number tonight, 855-450-FREE. And those are the things we're building here in
exactly.
New Hampshire. We're, you know, by the time you get here, if you haven't yet made the move, there's all kinds of organizations that you can get involved in that already exist. And if what you want to see doesn't exist, you can create that, and then people will jump on board. That's how it works here in the Free State Project. It's Free Talk Live.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom, and with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
As a pioneer of the e-commerce movement, Overstock.com is proud to be the first major retailer to accept Bitcoin. Overstock was the first because Patrick Byrne, Overstock's CEO and founder, firmly believes in personal freedom and cryptocurrency. Over the past 16 years, Overstock has furnished over 18 million homes with a diverse line of products to suit everyone's unique styles and preferences. Support Overstock and freedom of choice while enjoying free shipping on orders of 0.211 Bitcoin or more.
We've had an amazing year here at Supernatural Silver. We've truly enjoyed the fantastic response from thousands of people as they've tried our extraordinary product, and we're thrilled at the life-changing results people have. Our company email is continually full of happy, satisfied customers who thank us for the help they've received from Supernatural Silver. This holiday season, as you think of gifts to give your loved ones, consider giving Supernatural Silver, a gift that can help provide good health and wellness, a gift that can change lives and make a real difference. In a world where we are constantly exposed to dangerous health threats, give yourself and your loved ones a fighting chance. Give Supernatural Silver. Go to supernaturalsilver.com and use the promo code HOLIDAY2015 for 20% off. And this holiday season, we wish you and yours the blessings of peace and good health from all of us here at supernaturalsilver.com.
I've been told no in many different ways.
I give you an order and you're going to obey it.
George, you can go this way.
You can't do that and you have to leave here.
You cannot bring Simon to the rally.
Walk with me.
Well, I'm comfortable here, actually.
Whoa, excuse me. Hey.
Who do you think
excuse
you
me.
There is no video or audio allowed in this office.
No, I have work today. This is...
You ain't going to make it.
Wait a minute.
Now.
Wait a minute.
Hey! Oh my God! Unbelievable!
Why are you running from me?
Because you scared me!
What am I being detained for?
You're being served.
What is this?
You're being served.
What is this?
Bureaucrats have a funny way of telling people no.
That's the sound of the men working on the chain.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
LRN.fm is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for LRN.fm in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate us 5 stars, then share the link on your social media and let your friends and family know how you're listening to LRN.fm. Download it now, free, at apps.lrn.fm.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading on Thursday, gold is $1 lower at $1,063 per ounce. Silver is even at $13.93 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $423 US. Our offices are closed this week for year-end processes and to enjoy the holidays with family and friends. But you can still shop our online store at rrbi.co for some of the best deals you'll find on silver and gold. rrbi.co.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live, you can join us here in the remaining moments. We've got enough time for you if you dial in now at 855-450-FREE. We're talking about the activism movement here, the liberty activism movement in New Hampshire, which is unparalleled in the rest of the world. There's nothing that even comes close. There's no larger liberty community anywhere out there. There are a few that are kind of, you know, claiming to be competitors, but no, I'm sorry. They're not even anything that is even a fraction of what is going on here in New Hampshire. If you haven't yet gone to freestateproject.org, as Rich Paul pointed out, you don't want to. If you're going to be a part of this movement, you don't want to be in the second 20,000. You want to be in the first 20,000. And right now, it's coming up on 93% of that goal. And we were talking about sort of the activism infrastructure that has been built and continues to be built here, both on and off the air. We were talking about it. You mentioned, Joelle, some of the activism centers. We have different areas of the state, so Keene and the Seacoast and Manchester and Concord, and there's these places where people can come and gather and get to know one another and plot various different activist projects and things like that.
Exactly, and they keep on growing. And the good thing is, in just about every region that's in the lower half of the state, you can find at least a few people to do something. For example, over a course of 2 days, I managed to direct 7 activism operations in 7 different cities, right? Mm-hmm. 5 jury outreach things, and then 5 in one day.
Yep.
At this exact same time in 5 different cities, right? How easy is it to get that accomplished anywhere else
no,
in the world
you can't
with
do
just
it.
One location?
Yep.
How do you get like a couple people to come with you? But you can just
it's hard.
And then on the second day, another couple locations. And it's that sort of underscores the fact that we are everywhere around here. There's at least a few activists.
Expect us.
Yeah. Just about it. Yeah, just about everywhere.
I mean, oh, you activists, you liberty activists are inconsequential. You guys are nothing. The Free State Project's a joke.
Well, guess what? 3,000 jurors informed of the right to nullify last year.
Yeah.
There's a lot of towns with much lower population than that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, this is what we're hearing in the haters, of
exactly.
course.
Exactly.
They would love to have other people believe that the Free Staters are inconsequential, but yet they spend all manner of their time on our blogs and commenting and telling us how inconsequential that we are.
Yeah, just wait. I mean, the headlines are racking up. For example, the whole free Uber situation out in the coast has been massive.
I would say for 2015, free Uber was probably the biggest
crown jewel,
success story as far as
the biggest jewel
publicity.
In the crown of liberty activism in New Hampshire, possibly.
I'd say for raw actual activism, probably what you did with the jury outreach is probably reaching people more directly than free Uber. But as far as publicity is concerned, free Uber
yes,
takes the
exactly.
cake.
And then also,
it's nice how everything dovetails, though, because going back to jury nullification, we had the people in the legislature who passed the law.
That's right.
We have people out talking about jury nullification, and we have activists out doing civil disobedience who might benefit from jury nullification.
And attorneys in court talking
and
about
attorneys
it.
In court. So it all works together.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes. Now, there's a... It's interesting to talk about also about working with people who don't necessarily agree with you on everything.
Mm-hmm.
For example, a lot of the stuff that I did that was much less reported over the last year because it was part of my job was more legislative-based activism. And during the recent Free the Nipple controversy, right, a couple legislators in New Hampshire attempted or have sponsored a bill to... make it a misdemeanor to expose female nipples in public.
Yeah, we talked about it a lot on Saturday.
Even if they're yours.
Yes. And one of the co-sponsors of the bill, actually, who will remain unnamed, has been a great ally of mine in these other political fights. Mm. And then here this thing happens, And I, of course, I shake my head and I have to disagree with that. But you can use people on both sides. And again, the person promoting the whole free the nipple movement, as we already covered, is anti-Second Amendment, is anti-gun rights. And so
one of the two people who were arrested for
exactly.
it.
Exactly. So you don't have to agree with them on that, but you can definitely work with them on those sorts of issues. And that kind of thinking, for example, in the mayoral race in Manchester this last year was won by, I think, 57 votes. Hmm. And the reason it was, close and not a defeat on the person calling for greater government control. I mean, there was no, of the two choices, neither was very good. But one
as tends to be the case.
But one, for example, the one who ended up winning, for example, favored a tax cap, right? Okay. And so that there was a lot of people doing get out the vote for pro-liberty voters, a lot of Free Staters doing that behind the scenes. And so it is not unrealistic to say that without Free Stater involvement, that mayoral race would have changed.
Could have been different.
Well, it would have been. It's almost certain, actually.
Yeah, and I think there's also some interesting things that have gone on. I mean, there are there's a lot of attention paid to the more sort of newsworthy activism, the stuff that gets the headlines, the free Uber, the Robin Hooding, free the nipple. But free Uber and Robin Hooding is a real Free Stater kind of centric activism. And of course, that also leads to a lot of critique, a lot of people saying, well, you know, you guys are doing it wrong. And one of the things that can be done here is you can come here and do it better, right? So please come show me a better way to do this, which is one of the reasons I appreciate you, Joel, because, you know, you're an activist. You're out in the streets. You got a great article up right now over at I think it's only at thedesertlinks.com.
Yes, I'll end up cross-posting on the Rights Brigade. I haven't sort of figured out how I'm going to start putting out training manuals on that site yet. But right now it is at thedesertlinks.com.
It's called Effective Liberty Activism Crash Course. It was just posted yesterday, and so thedesertlinks.com. I recommend anybody who's interested in being an activist or who already is to take a look at it, because there's a lot that you can learn. There's, you know, a lot of things that you can learn from reading that we've learned the hard way by doing it.
Yeah, I can't say that I got this down from the heavens on a stone tablet or anything, or I can't say that I have always followed this either myself. Sure. I've made a lot of mistakes and then written what not to do.
Yeah, exactly. And so, but all that said, you know, despite whatever negativity might be out there, despite the cabbies attacking the free Uber drivers, despite the people attacking the Robin Hooders in the streets here in Keene, I think overall things are getting better for Free Staters here in New Hampshire, and specifically even here in Keene. I'll give you an example. I just had a phone call today from the chief of police. And normally that's a bad thing when the police call you. But in this case, I didn't.
How much is bail?
I didn't approach it as I didn't approach it as like, you know, a negative immediately. The first thing that I said when he identified himself, I mean, I saw the caller ID that it was Keene Police, and I answered the call and it was him. And I said, well, you know, how can I help you? That's generally how I'll answer calls. And I treated him no differently. And he was actually calling to let me know that he'd been contacting news media. He'd contacted the Keene Sentinel. He'd contacted the local radio station cluster. And he wanted to reach out to me as well, because I'm the founder of Free Keene. And he wanted to let me know that there have been several heroin overdoses in Western Massachusetts and in the Keene area over the last weekend, that they had found that it was a particular brand of heroin, which was identified as the Hollywood branded heroin. And he asked if I would consider, you know, maybe getting the word out about this. And I said, I'll take a look. He pointed me to his Facebook, the Keene Police Facebook page. I went and I looked, and I went ahead and made a blog post about it, because I'm willing to work with the police when they're doing the right thing. And in the case of harm reduction, the police are doing the right thing. The putting the word out about a bad batch of heroin that is, you know, leading to overdoses is a positive thing for the community. Exactly. Arresting heroin users is not. And of course, I made that point in the blog post that I made about it, so people could learn something about the war on drugs at the same time. But the fact that the new police chief is willing to call, you know, on Free Keene to, you know, ask for a favor, I think is an indicator that things are changing here. Whereas the previous police chief would pretend like I don't exist. Me and Pete and Dave Ridley, whenever we would encounter the former police chief, he'd act like a small child and not even speak when spoken to, not even acknowledge, not even look at you when you said hello to him. Whereas the new guy...
I got that response from him when I was doing the 420 rally, and literally I'd walked up to the guy and said, look, I'm running the 420 rally. I want to make sure that nobody gets hurt. So if you want... If you have issues with what I'm doing or you believe I'm doing anything dangerous, I want to hear about it. He said not a word.
Yeah,
same
it's
thing.
Just ridiculous behavior.
It was childish.
Yes, it's been on the up and up with the jury outreach, for example. Usually when there's when outreach comes to a new courthouse that hasn't been done before, once in a while you'll get a bailiff come out. What are you guys doing? A couple times, but it's always been peacefully resolved. Again, one of the things that I talk about in terms of how to be more effective activist is is isolation of issues. So I don't try to do it. I have the right to be on this. I try to just diffuse that. I'm only here to do this one thing. And it's had a lot of good success.
Joel Valenzuela from rightsbrigade.com. Thanks for coming in here, making the trip out out east. We'll see you tomorrow. Freetalklive.com.
This is a national health care alert from the Health Hotline. If you, a family member, or a loved one suffers from knee pain and have Medicare as your primary insurance, we've got great news. You could qualify for a pain-relieving knee brace at little or no cost to you. Get free delivery, and all the paperwork is handled by our accredited suppliers at no charge to you. So if you're on Medicare and have knee pain, don't wait. You may qualify to immediately receive a pain-relieving knee brace at little or no cost. Friendly agents are standing by 24/7 to help you. We also have other pain-relieving braces, too, for your shoulder, ankle, or back. You may be eligible to get these items and more at little or no out-of-pocket cost. Our friendly representatives are standing by now to help you, so please call now. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963. 800-301-2963.
Did you know that Free Aid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At Free Aid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. Free Aid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The Free Aid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
This is the Liberty Radio Network, broadcasting the latest liberty-oriented audio content 24 hours a day at lrn.fm.
Hi, I'm Derek J. To me, an activist's calling is to actively work to advance a cause. The cause for which I work is personal freedom. I believe my life is best when I engage in voluntary interactions and self-government. I reject the idea that anyone else has a higher claim to my life or my body than I do. I see people who call themselves the government as a threat to my personal freedom. I realize you may feel differently, but my relationship with the people who call themselves the government is completely involuntary. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
LRN.FM is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for LRN.FM in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate us 5 stars, then share the link on your social media and let your friends and family know how you're listening to LRN.FM. Download it now, free, at apps.lrn.fm.
Currency is too important a thing to be left in the hands of government bureaucrats, especially when billions of dollars can be created with the swipe of a pen. Overstock.com supports the cryptocurrency movement because it returns the power of an inflation-proof money to the people where it belongs. Did you know that you can use Bitcoin to pay for anything Overstock.com sells while enjoying free shipping on orders of 0.211 Bitcoin or more? If you support freedom in the cryptocurrency movement, you should support Overstock.com.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm. The latest edition of the Borderless Podcast is next on the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm. Get more at borderlessblog.com.
Welcome to the Borderless Podcast, your guide to traveling, investing, and living beyond borders, where we talk about living the life that you want to live, where you want to live it. From beautiful San Miguel de Allende, smack in the middle of Mexico. La Marita, somewhere in Mexico. With your host, Jonathan Lockwood and James Guzman.
Welcome to the Borderless Podcast, traveling, investing, and living beyond borders. My name's Jonathan Lockwood, and I'm here with James Guzman. Hey, James.
How's it going?
It's going good. How do you like this mezcal?
It is wonderful. Which one is this?
This is the Bequiche.
Oh, the Bequiche.
Yeah, it's one of. It's like the Madre Quiche. It's a little softer, I think, but I like it a lot.
Fantastic.
So this is our, it's a bit of a different Borderless Podcast today, because we're kind of just doing like the 2015 year-end wrap-up, and kind of talk about the, you know, the highlights maybe of 2015 and some of our various thoughts about how the year went and just new things in general.
You know? Yeah, it's been a pretty interesting year, and we've definitely grown a lot. The last one that we did, January 5th was Sustainable Life in Dominican Republic. So if you guys listening don't remember that one, you probably hadn't been following us for a year. It's really been a big change in the show and the community, and it's very, very exciting.
Right. And speaking of the community, James, you did a Survey Monkey earlier this year. What month was that? Do you recall?
I don't.
All right, that's okay. But it was a long time ago.
Yeah.
And at least for me, and I think also you, it was a surprise because it just looked like our typical listener wasn't what I was imagining they were. Mm-hmm. So it was very helpful, and I think we probably need to do one again. But, you know, so what it came out to be is about 37% are either expats or permanent travelers, while